Welcome to the fantasy audiobook, Pirates, The Fake Marine in the Straw Hat Pirates. Chapter 41. Ike, Luffy, what are you doing? Sanji asked after lighting a cigarette. I am exercising. Ike laughed and did two presses with a giant mousetrap. Luffy, who had been struggling, echoed, that's right. I'm also exercising. Eat on the sly, don't look for excuses. While talking, Sanji released Luffy, and Ike was able to break free from the mouse trap. Then Sanji looked at the little girl who was pale with fright and said, are you hungry too? The little girl didn't speak, just shook her head desperately. She was really frightened just now. If such a big mouse trap was caught on her body, she would probably be cut in half. Just as the little girl shook her head, her stomach growled, which made her blush. When Luffy heard this sound, he forgot about the embarrassment of being caught in a mousetrap and started to slap his legs and laugh. Ha ha ha, you are just hungry. Ike also slumped down on the chair and said, Sanji, help me cook more meat, I'm starving to death. Sanji heard this, nodded, and then started cooking. Within 10 minutes, a feast of meat-based meals was prepared by Sanji. Luffy and Ike began to fight for food without ceremony. Seeing this scene, Sanji was a little curious, Ike, why have you become a big eater? And where did your hair go? At this time, Sanji began to observe the changes in Ike. At this time, not only was Ike's hair gone, his body was also much stronger than before, and even the muscles on his arms looked very distinct. In addition, Ike's height also increased by a few centimeters. Before, Ike was only about 1.75 meters tall, but now Ike is at least 1.8 meters tall. This, we'll talk about it after, woo, we'll talk about it later. I'll finish eating first. Ike responded while stuffing meat into his mouth, noticing that Luffy was eating faster, and Ike also speeded up. Sanji looked at the little girl who still refused to move her chopsticks and said, if you don't eat, the food will be eaten by them both. The little girl still looked a little reluctant when she heard this. While Luffy was eating, he glanced at Ike out of the corner of his eye and almost spit out the food in his mouth when he saw Ike's bald head. However, in order not to waste the food, he still swallowed it forcefully. After taking a sip of water, Luffy saw that the little girl didn't touch the food in front of her. Whether intentionally or not, he put down the water glass and reached out to pick up the plate in front of the little girl. He smiled and said, since you don't want to eat, then give it to me. Seeing this, the little girl immediately started to protect the food. Who said I don't want to eat? After saying this, the little girl picked up the plate and took a few bites. The taste of the food immediately made her smile. This is delicious. At this moment, Nami, Usopp, and Zoro, who had been eavesdropping outside, also walked in. Nami came to the little girl and asked with a smile, you know we are pirates, so you are scared, right? Nami's words made the little girl smile awkwardly. Haha, that's right. In this era, hearing about pirates will give you the same reaction. But don't worry, we are not some vicious pirates. Hearing what Nami said, although he was still a little wary, he was much more relaxed than before. At this moment, Ike, who had already eaten, stood up and said, say your name and where you live and we will take you home. Ike knows that this little girl is called Abyssi and lives on Battleship Island, and there is also a thousand-year dragon hidden on Battleship Island who is about to die of old age. In order to obtain the so-called thousand-year dragon bone, Marine captured Abyssi and wanted to know the whereabouts of the thousand-year dragon. It is said that the bones of the thousand-year dragon can make the elixir of immortality. Ike thinks it is nonsense, but some people in Marine really believe it. Ike's strength has increased, so he wants to enter the Grand Line as soon as possible, but he has no interest in this kind of branch plot. Ike's words immediately attracted everyone's attention. When they saw Ike's bald head, Usopp, Luffy and Zoro couldn't help laughing. Usopp covered his mouth and pointed at Ike's head and asked, PFF'd. Ike, why did you become bald? Is this the result of your retreat? Zoro also said with a smile. Luffy didn't speak, but he kept laughing. He was about to forget about Ike's bald head, but he was infected by Usopp's laughter and started laughing again. Hey, are you so slow to respond? I've been sitting here all the time. Ike, maybe your bald head was too bright and dazzling, so we didn't pay attention. Usopp explained with a smile. Usopp's words immediately made Luffy's laughter grow even louder. Ike saw this and punched Luffy on the head. The reason why I don't hit Usopp is because now I can't control his power 100%. It would be embarrassing if he accidentally smashed Usopp to death. But if you hammer Luffy, there is no risk. Luffy was knocked to the ground by Ike's punch. Seeing this, Zoro immediately put away his smile. From the punch Ike just made, he found that Ike's power was much stronger than before. After punching Luffy, Ike raised his fist and looked at Usopp. Usopp saw this and immediately covered his mouth with his hands. Seeing these people playing around, the little girl felt that these people were not bad people, so she told her name. "My name is ABC, and I live on Battleship Island. Please send me home." After hearing this, Nami immediately took out the map and quickly found the location of Battleship Island. "Left rudder, go east, let's go to Battleship Island." After planning the route, Nami said to the others. Soon, everyone became busy, controlling the sails, and steering the helm. After working for a while, it was daybreak. "Ike, hurry, take out the magical items you summoned before." When the Golden Mary sailed normally, Luffy approached Ike expectantly. Luffy hopes that Ike will come up with something new like a sea bike. After all, the time spent on the ship is a bit too boring. After hearing Luffy's words, others also looked over expectantly. Seeing this, Ike had no choice but to take out the things that he had no use for that he had planned to give away. They are 5 bamboo dragonflies, an elf ball, a suit including leather shoes, an ordinary flashlight and a potted plant. While taking out things, Ike began to introduce the functions of these things. After listening to the functions of these magical items, Luffy directly picked up a bamboo dragonfly and put it on his head. Then he flew up with a thought. Just when he was about to fly away from the Golden Merle, he was caught. Nami stopped. At this time, Ike also realized that no means of transportation could allow Luffy to play alone, otherwise he would definitely cause a lot of trouble and even get lost. Seeing that no one would let him play with bamboo dragonflies, Luffy turned his attention to the Pokeball again. He picked up the elf ball and pressed the button on it, directly releasing the sleeping duck inside. Kodakaya opened his eyes in confusion. After seeing the unfamiliar environment, he covered his head with his short arms, as if he had a headache. Seeing such a fat duck, Luffy naturally thought of eating it immediately. It was also the first time for Sanji to see such a big and plump duck, and he couldn't help but murmured, "Such a fat duck, roasted on the outside and tender on the inside, sliced and sprinkled with special sauce, it should taste delicious." Hearing Sanji's words, Luffy's mouth almost watered. "Come on, Sanji, let's bake it." As if feeling the malice, Kodakaya covered his head and ran away in a hurry. Echo was also a little speechless. Echo could accept whatever Pokemon he drew, but this Kodak was really something he couldn't accept. The Gotha Duck is powerful, but before it evolves into the Gotha Duck, its combat effectiveness can be said to be unstable at all. Just when Ike wanted to step forward to stop Luffy from catching the duck, Luffy had already stretched out his arm and caught the duck. After being caught, Kodak let out a croaking scream, and then his eyes suddenly emitted a strange blue light, and Luffy found that his body could not move. Ike knew that at this moment Kodak felt the power of danger released. "Luffy, the duck is not for food. It will also be our partner in the future. Although it is not very useful." Hearing Ike's words, Zoro pointed speechlessly at the duck that could easily control Luffy and said, "You say this is not very useful. Strong ability, but difficult to control," Ike explained. At this moment, Nami stepped forward and hugged Kodak. Although the Kodak duck looks a bit silly, it is still very cute and adorable. Nami fell in love with it the first time she saw it. The duck felt like it was being hugged and wanted to resist, but when Nami's hand touched its head, the duck immediately stopped moving. "Miss Nami is so kind." Seeing this, Sanji began to circle around Nami, and his eyes became heart-shaped. After Luffy learned that the Kodak couldn't be eaten and was still a companion, he gave up immediately. "There is actually a set of clothes here." Luffy picked up the brutal suit, but only looked at it twice before throwing it aside, hitting Sanji's body. Seeing this, Ike said to Sanji, "You are the only one wearing a suit on the boat, so I will give you this suit." Sanji heard this and didn't refuse. Through Ike's explanation just now, Sanji knew that this suit can increase strength and agility, and it is indeed very suitable for him. In the end, only the food tree and the shrinking flashlight are left. Luffy took the flashlight and shined it at Usopp beside him. Usopp's figure shrank directly. Oh, this is fun. Luffy immediately found something interesting and irradiated Usopp several times in succession, and Usopp became the size of a fingernail. Ike took the flashlight over and turned on the enlargement button to change Usopp back. Luffy has already thought of a very cool operation, that is, to make himself smaller, wouldn't it mean that he can eat meat directly and enjoy it? Thinking of this, Luffy shouted to Sanji who was studying the food tree, "Sanji, make me a piece of meat, I want the kind with bones." "Wait a minute," Sanji replied to Luffy, then looked at Ike and asked, "Can this tree really grow delicious food? What kind of delicious food can it grow specifically?" Hearing Sanji's question, Ike replied, "It depends on how you cultivate it. To cultivate a food tree, you need to fertilize it, and the fertilizer you apply is some of the food you make. What food do you bury in the soil? It will grow whatever food it can." Ike's explanation is exactly how the food tree is used. The food tree comes from the prisoner of food, naturally. In the world of the prisoner of food, the cultivation of the food tree is not that troublesome. After all, it is a world full of food, and no one knows how much food is buried in the soil. But this food tree produced by the system needs to be planted and cultivated by yourself. After listening to Ike's explanation, Sanji had his own ideas about this food tree. For example, if you fertilize it with some spices, it will grow spices. If you fertilize with food, food will grow. In this way, there is no need to worry about lack of food on the sea. As for letting the food tree grow food directly, Sanji won't do that. Sanji is a chef. In his opinion, the most important ingredient in the dishes he makes is heart. Sanji hopes that the food his companions eat is food cooked by himself, rather than produced like an assembly line. Naturally, if conditions permit, if Sanji is really starving to death, Sanji will not think about the origin of food. The first priority is to fill his stomach. After moving the food tree to the place where the orange trees were planted in Mele, Sanji took out some commonly used spices and accessories and fertilized it for the first time. After setting up the food tree, he went to cook meat for Luffy. When the meat was placed in front of Luffy, Luffy said to Ike, "Ike, make me smaller." After hearing Luffy's words, Ike immediately knew what he wanted to do. "I said Luffy, it's useless to do this. The shrinking light can only reduce your size and weight. Although you will eat very well, it will basically mean that you haven't eaten anything after you transform, because you eat it. The food doesn't get bigger." Luffy said he couldn't understand Ike's explanation. Seeing this, Ike could only let Luffy experience it for himself. Ike directly shrunk everyone present, including Obese, leaving only herself on the deck. After becoming smaller, Luffy Usopp started eating meat crazily. "It feels so good," Luffy shouted as he lay on the meat and kept eating. "Others are enjoying being smaller. Ike can really come up with a lot of magical props." Zoro also ate a piece of meat, then took a sip of wine and said, "With this lamp, we can store more things on the ship." "This is not possible." Regarding Zoro's proposal, Usopp directly rejected it. "Didn't Ike say that shrinking and other things are time sensitive? If the time limit is reached, the Mary will be hurt." At the same time, just as everyone was experiencing the shrinking journey, a warship had already caught up with the Golden Mele. This warship is the team chasing Obese. The leader is a major, and there is also a mercenary Eric on the ship. When the major saw the Golden Mary, he originally had no intention of pursuing it. To him, it was just a little pirate. The most important thing now was to catch the little girl Obese. "It's just a small pirate group, let's let it go for now." Just as the major finished speaking, Eric stepped forward, took out Luffy's bounty list and said, "This is not a small pirate group. Your Majesty, Major. A head worth 30 million can make waves in the East China Sea." After seeing the 30 million reward list, the major frowned and said, "Headquarters has informed me that this 30 million reward has been invalidated." Eric was also surprised when he heard this. It was also the first time he heard that besides seven warlords of the sea, there were also bounty lists being invalidated. "But even so, we still have to stop them. There is only one ship nearby, and the little girl might be caught by the people on this ship." When the major heard this, he felt that it made sense. Just at this time, Ike used 1,000 miles of flying to fly to the warship. When the marine soldiers saw Ike falling from the sky, they raised their guns and pointed them at him. Seeing this, Ike took out the private marine appointment letter and handed it over and said, "One of my own, I am General Ike of the Private Marine Marine." The major took the letter of appointment and saw the seal of Marine's headquarters on it. He knew that it should be true, and, allowing Marine to remove the reward order showed that the background of this ship was not shallow, and it was better not to provoke it. The major first made a gesture to put down his gun to his surrounding men, and then returned the appointment letter to Iktau. "Mr. Private Marine, have you ever seen a little girl?" Hearing this, Ike shook his head decisively and said, "I haven't seen it before. We still have a mission assigned by Lieutenant General Garp, so I won't say more." Upon hearing this, the major saluted and sent Ike flying back to the Golden Mary. Seeing that the major let him go like this, Eric said in a somewhat unhappy tone, "Hey, Major, don't you even do a search? How are you going to explain to Admiral Nelson?" Although Eric is a mercenary, in this mission, he actually hopes to get the thousand-year dragon bone the most. After all, who doesn't want to live forever? If he wanted to get clues about the Millennium Dragon Bone, Abyss was the key. Eric didn't want to let go of this clue. His intuition told him that Abyss was definitely on that pirate ship. The major shook his head and said nothing. In fact, even if Abyss was really on that ship, he would not dare to search it. How could the background of withdrawing the 30 million bounty be simple? Go back and report this matter to Admiral Nelson first. I will take the initiative to accept the punishment. After saying that, the major ordered his men to set sail and go back. After Ike returned to the Golden Mary, he used the shrinking flashlight to change everyone back to their original size. The smaller Luffy's belly became bloated due to eating a lot of meat, but when he returned to his original size, his belly also changed back. This made Luffy suddenly feel an indescribable feeling of emptiness. Seeing Luffy's slumped face, Ike smiled and said, "You can feel it. After you become smaller, you can only experience the pleasure of eating, but it won't make you full." Luffy was a little disappointed when he heard this, but, it's nice to experience the pleasure of eating meat. There was a warship chasing over just now, and it seemed that it was here to hunt down Abyss. Ike recounted what had just happened. After everyone heard this, they all turned their attention to Abyss. Seeing this, Abyss quickly explained, I don't know what Marine is going to do if he catches me. I did escape from Marine before." Seeing Abyss like this, everyone knew that she must be hiding something. But since they had agreed to send her home, no one said anything else. They couldn't just throw her off the boat because of her concealment. This is not the style of the Straw Hats. The style of the Straw Hats is that thieves can cause trouble, they are never afraid of trouble, they just like to cause trouble. Just when Abyss was a little embarrassed, Nami pointed to an island in the distance that looked like a warship and said, "We're here, Warship Island." After hearing Nami's words, everyone came to the deck and saw the appearance of Battleship Island, which indeed looked like a huge warship. As soon as the Golden Melee approached the shore, it saw a group of villagers waiting nervously with weapons in their hands. Luffy laughed when he saw this and said, "A lot of people are greeting us." "Idiot." Nami rolled her eyes at Luffy and said, "It seems like they are here to deal with us." In order to avoid misunderstandings, Ike first asked Abyss to get off the boat and explain to the villagers. Knowing that the Straw Hat Pirates were good pirates, many villagers also put down their weapons. In this way, everyone, led by Abyss, arrived at her grandfather's house. The old man said that he would use exclusive steamed buns to thank everyone in the Straw Hats for sending Abyss home. Of course, Luffy was also very interested in the old man's exclusive steamed buns, so he led everyone to wait and listen to the old man telling stories. At the same time, the major and Eric returned to the main ship and informed Admiral Nelson of what had happened previously. Admiral Nelson was built like a mountain of meat and held a small folding fan in his hand. After listening to the report of his major, his small eyes narrowed. "If you can't handle this, what else can you do? If you know that the other party has a background, then you won't pretend that you don't know and arrest the little girl on the boat first." Upon hearing this, the major immediately lowered his head and did not dare to speak anymore. Seeing this, Admiral Nelson waved his hand and said, "All troops obey the order and set off for Battleship Island." Nelson's idea is very simple. Since the little girl is from Battleship Island, other people on Battleship Island should also have clues about the Thousand-Year Dragon. As for what to do if you meet the Straw Hats, what else can you do? If you are in the way, of course you will kill him directly. Do you need an explanation for killing a 30 million pirate? As for canceling the wanted order, just say you don't know. In this way, under the order of Admiral Nelson, dozens of mighty warships sailed towards the warship island. Other side, except for Ike who was practicing boxing outside, the rest of the Straw Hats were basically made drowsy by the old man's story. Just when Ike was concentrating on practicing boxing, he saw Abi sneaking into the kitchen, putting the steamed buns into a bag, and running towards the mountains of Battleship Island with the bag on her shoulders. Before Ike could catch up, Luffy opened his nostrils and followed the scent of the buns. It was obvious that he was sleepwalking. Just like that, Luffy smelled the aroma of the buns, Ike followed Luffy, and behind Ike was Nami. Several people came to a cave on the Battleship Island mountain together. A thousand-year-old dragon that is about to die of old age is lying in this cave. When Abyss saw Luffy, Echo and Nami chasing after her, she subconsciously wanted to protect the Millennium Dragon. Luffy stepped forward and didn't look at the thousand-year dragon. Instead, he opened the bag containing the buns and started eating like crazy. At this time, Luffy still hadn't woken up. Seeing Luffy actually eating the buns she prepared for Lord Long, Abyss' face turned red with anger. Luffy, that's what I gave to Master Long. Abyss's voice immediately woke up Luffy who was still sleepwalking. After Luffy ate the bun in his mouth and in his hand, he asked in confusion, "Where am I?" At this time, Luffy noticed that there was a huge creature in front of him. "Wow, what is this, so amazing." As he spoke, Luffy rushed forward and stroked him while saying excitedly, "This is actually alive, so amazing." Abyss kept pulling Luffy, but Luffy didn't move at all. Luffy looked into Master Long's eyes and asked, "How awesome. Where did you come from?" After hearing Luffy's words, Millennium Dragon raised his eyelids and looked at him with somewhat lifeless eyes. It was at this glance that Luffy felt the sadness in the Millennium Dragon's heart. "I see, you want to go back to your hometown." Abyss didn't expect that Luffy could also hear Master Long's thoughts. Luffy said that he just felt it, and actually couldn't hear Master Long's heart. Ike knew that this was Luffy's talent, the talent to listen to all things. "I said, is this really a dragon? I feel like it's more like a bird." Ike stepped forward, looked at Master Long carefully, and then said, "Master Long is a dragon. He is a thousand-year-old dragon." Abyss said with certainty, and then told Marine the real reason for arresting her. Thousand-year-old dragon bone. Elixir of immortality. Nami was also a little surprised, and thought to himself, this old and shabby old dragon can make the elixir of life. Wouldn't that be very valuable? At this moment, the pokeball in Nami's pocket flashed with white light, and the Kodak appeared out of nowhere and began to steal the spotlight and presence. After learning about Master Long's situation, Luffy planned to take Master Long away from here to find his hometown. Ike knows that Battleship Island is actually the hometown of Master Long. It is also the place where the Millennium Dragon returns to its nest and where the Millennium Dragon hatches the new Millennium Dragon. It's just that this Dragon Master is a thousand-year-old dragon who has been lost for thousands of years, and he is too old and confused to remember this place of return. In fact, the thousand-year-old dragon will also choose to return to its nest when it dies. The reason why Lord Long is entrenched here is because he knows that this is the place where he will return to his roots. This is the instinct of animals. Just when Ike was about to tell this, Usopp hurriedly rushed into the cave. "Luffy, Ike, Nami, is not good." Seeing Luffy and the other three, Usopp leaned on his knees and panted while saying, "Marine. Marine has surrounded the warship island." After taking a moment to catch his breath, Usopp opened his eyes. Seeing the huge dragon lord, Usopp's eyes widened. "I'm going to, here, what is this?" Ignoring the surprised Usopp, Ike frowned and said, "It looks like, we're in trouble." Ike didn't expect that even though he revealed his identity and said he was Garp's subordinate, he still failed to calm Marine. But it's right to think about it carefully, after all, it is the temptation of immortality. Moreover, Marine is not the only one who wishes to live forever, but also those fools from the Celestial Dragons. As long as he offers the elixir of life to the Celestial Dragons, that fat Admiral Nelson will probably be promoted and make a fortune. "Ike, what should we do?" Nami asked looking at Ike. Nami knows that although she and others are pirates, they are also private marines. If they really take action against marines, the identities of private marines will be at stake. Ike also fell into deep thought after hearing this. When he caught sight of Lord Long, he immediately thought of a good idea. Luffy, go and call Sanji and Zoro back. I have an idea. Luffy trusted Ike very much and rushed out of the cave to find Zoro and Sanji without asking what he could do. 10 minutes later, all members of the Straw Hat Pirates gathered at the cave. Ike first told Mr. Long's situation and said that he would not hand him over. After learning Ike's thoughts, Zoro pushed He Dao Yiwen out with his thumb and said, "So we still want to fight?" Ike nodded and said, "We do want to fight, but, not as our identities, but, as the Millennium Dragon." Other side, the Marine fleet led by Admiral Nelson directly surrounded the entire Battleship Island. They also captured several villagers from Battleship Island and forced them to find out the whereabouts of Abyss. Haha, that little girl actually returned to Battleship Island. That couldn't be better. After hearing what Admiral Nelson said, one of his colonels asked in confusion, "Admiral Nelson, what about the Straw Hats and the gang? Huh, what else can we do? If they stop us, just take action and kill them." Having said this, Admiral Nelson looked at the sparse civilians on the warship island with a fierce light in his eyes and said, "If these ordinary people prevent us from obtaining the keel, I will still kill them." Nelson's men did not expect that he would be so crazy, and they were a little more afraid of this mountain of meat. By the way, where did Eric go? After hearing Nelson's question, Colonel Marine replied, "He seems to have gone to Battleship Island first." Just as the Marine Colonel finished speaking, a burst of beast roars came from the depths of the warship island. Along with the beast's roar, four huge creatures flew out from the depths of Battleship Island. They have dragon-like heads and bird-like feathers on their bodies. Although they are more like birds, Admiral Nelson recognized them at the first sight. They were exactly the thousand-year-old dragons he had been searching for. "Those are thousand-year-old dragons. Quickly, shoot them down with cannons," Nelson shouted in a very excited tone. After hearing Nelson's order, many marines set up their cannons and started firing cannonballs at several thousand-year dragons. Bang, bang, bang. Bursts of gunfire rang out, but they were easily dodged by several thousand-year dragons. One of the thousand-year-old dragons kicked a warship with its claws. The huge body of the thousand-year-old dragon immediately kicked a warship into pieces. Since Admiral Nelson's marine fleet is connected by iron chains, the kick of the Millennium Dragon not only destroyed a warship, but also sank the warships on both sides into the sea. At the same time, the other 3,000-year dragons also moved. One of the Millennium Dragon's claws suddenly grew longer, and then it swept across, destroying three warships in an instant. There was also a 1,000-year-old dragon holding a huge piece of wood in its mouth. Its spread wings and the piece of wood in its mouth formed a three-sword flow ghost slash, which took away three more warships in one wave. The last one grabbed a huge stone with its claws and used it to sink a warship. In less than 10 minutes, Admiral Nelson lost most of his fleet, which also made him feel like he was having a myocardial infarction. "Admiral, our losses have been too great, we should retreat." "Yes, if we continue, we will be completely annihilated. These thousand-year-old dragons are not something we can provoke." After hearing the persuasion from his subordinates, Nelson was very reluctant. After all, this was the elixir of immortality that he had dreamed of. At the same time, several thousand-year-old dragons in midair also communicated with each other. "Thousand-year dragon Luffy. I turned into a thousand-year dragon, it's so fun." "Zoro Millennium Dragon. I didn't expect Ike to have such a method." "Sanji Millennium Dragon. But this is indeed a good idea." "Usopp Millennium Dragon. Ha ha ha, let's try Captain Usopp's stone attack again." "Sanji Millennium Dragon. It's already like this, why don't they retreat?" "Zoro Millennium Dragon. It looks like we have to destroy that main ship." "Luffy Millennium Dragon. I'll come, I'll come." The marines below naturally couldn't understand the exchanges between several thousand-year dragons. They could only see several thousand-year dragons making roars, which made them more and more nervous, fearing that they would become the prey of the thousand-year dragons. A goal. At this time, many marine soldiers have boarded the warship island, because it is too unsafe on the warship. While Admiral Nelson was still debating whether to retreat, Luffy's Millennium Dragon had already flown towards his main ship. Seeing this, Nelson quickly ordered his men, "Quick, let me attack with the main gun." But just when the Marine soldiers were not adjusting the muzzle, Luffy Millennium Dragon was already standing on the deck of the main ship. It has to be said that the size of the main ship is more than double that of other warships, and the deck can completely stand up to the ground and fly the Millennium Dragon. Seeing that the thousand-year dragon in front of him did not attack immediately, Nelson broke out in a cold sweat on his forehead and said, "It's all a misunderstanding. Everything is a misunderstanding. I will withdraw my troops immediately." Luffy didn't listen to Nelson's words. At this time, he was thinking about what moves to use to sink the warship. After thinking for a while, Luffy stretched his neck. With the size of a thousand-year-old dragon, if the neck is stretched instantly, the length will reach the sky. After pulling his neck to its longest length, Luffy's neck snapped back instantly, and his head hit the deck of the warship. Just hearing a boom, the main ship was instantly shattered. In the cave of Battleship Island, Ike put away the monkey charm. The plan Ike mentioned before was to turn Luffy, Zoro, Sanji and Usopp into Millennium Dragons and then fight back as Millennium Dragons. After all, Nelson's goal is to kill the Thousand-Year Dragon and obtain the keel. It is reasonable for the Thousand-Year Dragon to fight back. This has nothing to do with the Straw Hats, a private marine group. At this time, only Ike, Nami, Abyss and Kota Duck were left in the cave, covering their heads and walking back and forth. Can they beat Marine? Abyss asked worriedly. Hearing Abyss's words, Nami smiled and said, "Don't worry. They are very strong." Abyss turned back and glanced at Lord Long. Only then did he realize that ever since he heard the roar of the Millennium Dragon transformed by Luffy and others, Lord Long's eyes had become brighter and brighter, as if he had remembered something. Ike knew that this should be Master Long's return to the light. After it calls its companions for a while, it will be the time for its death. Similarly, the size of Battleship Island will also increase, becoming the place where the Thousand-Year Dragon returns home. Just when Ike was about to fly out to check how the battle was going with Luffy and the others, a slender figure appeared at the entrance of the cave. This man was wearing tiny sunglasses, a crisp suit, a purple airplane head, and he looked very cool with one hand in his pocket. The person who came was none other than Eric, the mercenary hired by Marine. Similarly, he is also a user with the sickle fruit ability, and his fingers can produce wind blades. I didn't expect that in addition to the thousand-year-old dragon outside, there is an old dragon here. Seeing Eric, Nami took out her three-section stick and stood in front of Abyss. Eric glanced at Ike and Nami, and said coldly, "It's really an eyesore." As soon as he finished speaking, Eric pointed his sword at the two of them and slashed at them. Then two wind blades flew towards Eric and Nami. When Ike saw this scene, he also pointed his sword and blocked it with the same two wind blades. "Haha, my name is Ike, your name is Eric, you use wind, and I use wind. Don't you think you should disappear?" Ike said coldly. Seeing Ike's methods, Eric knew that the boy in front of him might be a strong enemy, so he immediately took out the hand from his pocket and planned to fight seriously. Ike smiled, just in time to try his other golden item, the spiritual bow, on him. Ike stretched out his right hand, revealing the cross bracelet on his wrist. Then with a thought, a blue-white spiritual bow appeared in his hand. Eric had a bad feeling when he saw this. He planned to strike first and slashed continuously with both hands, and then countless wind blades flew towards Ike. "Let me chop it into pieces." Seeing this, Ike calmly pulled the spiritual bow. At the same time, drink, wind barriers. Wind dispersion. When the words fell, all the wind blades released by Eric dissipated. In wind barriers, Ike can control any form of wind, and the wind blade that Eric cuts can be said to be defeated by Ike. Seeing this scene, Eric became even more panicked. Not only because the wind blade failed, but also because the special effects on Echo were too dazzling. The continuously gathering blue arrows made Eric's legs weak. Just after Ike felt that nearly 10% of his physical strength had been drained away, his left hand released the bowstring, and then a blue arrow flew towards Eric. Such a terrifying attack shocked Eric. At this moment, he remembered running under the sunset that day, which was his lost youth. "If God gives me another chance, I will never look for some thousand-year-old dragon bones. Isn't it better to live in the present?" After recalling his youth, Eric fainted. Ike's arrow did not hit him, but shaved off his plain head. It's not that Ike relented, but he really didn't. Am I not suitable to be an archer? Just as Ike was sighing, there was a sudden explosion in the distance. Ike looked along the entrance of the cave and saw that part of the top of another mountain on Warship Island had been flattened. This was caused by the attack of the spiritual bow. Hell, this spiritual bow is pretty powerful. It looks like I'm going to have a good practice with bows and arrows. Just when Ike was about to give Eric a last hit, there were gasps from behind. Ike looked back and saw Master Long standing up. Not only that, he also planned to walk out of the cave. Abyss, on the other hand, kept persuading. Abyss is a whisperer fruit user. She knows that Long Yi's health is very poor and he might die if he just goes out like this. Long Yi took a deep look at Abyss and said, "The time has come." "It's time." "What time?" Abyss asked doubtfully. Lord Long did not answer, but spread his wings and flew into the air. Luffy and the other four, who had successfully repelled the warship, were a little curious when they saw Master Long flying out. At this moment, Master Long looked up to the sky and roared. "Time is up. Time is up." Because of their transformation into the Thousand-Year Dragon, Luffy and the four of them can understand what Master Long is shouting. "Usopp's Millennium Dragon. What is this dragon's name? When is the time?" Luffy's Millennium Dragon stared at the old dragon who was about to expire in midair and said, "His time is almost up." Just as Luffy finished speaking, a group of Millennium Dragons flew in from a distance. After these Thousand-Year Dragons appeared, they began to hover in the midair of the entire Warship Island, and Master Long was at the center of these hovering Thousand-Year Dragons. Just when no one knew what these Thousand-Year Dragons were doing, the Warship Island below suddenly began to shake. Immediately, an island several times larger than Battleship Island emerged from the sea. Battleship Island only occupies a small part of this island. All the warships surrounding the island were stranded because of the sudden floating island, and the marines on it were also panicked. Not only the marine warship, but also the Golden Merlin also ran aground on the shoal. When the island appeared, Lord Long fell from the air as if he had completed his mission. Seeing this, Abyss said with tears in her eyes, It turns out that Lord Long has always been in his hometown. Nami also suddenly said, "So, the dragon's lair is indeed here. The name of the Millennium Dragon is not derived from their lifespan, but because they return to this island every 1,000 years. Millennium dragons have the instinct to migrate, and the large-scale appearance now is not accidental, but inevitable, because this lost island only floats up once every 1,000 years. Abyss didn't listen to Nami's words. At this time, all his eyes were on Mr. Long, who was lying motionless on the ground. "Master Long! Master Long!" Seeing that Master Long was motionless, Abyss ran directly down the mountain. When she got to Mr. Long's side, she found that Mr. Long was already dead. Looking at Master Long's motionless body, Abyss cried and said, "Master Long, didn't you say that you would get better as long as you returned to your hometown? Why did you lie to me?" Quote. Just then, Luffy and Zoro flew over. Seeing Abyss crying, Luffy said to her, "Master Long is a 1,000-year-old dragon who has lost his way. He has been lonely for 1,000 years. But in his last days, he met his friend Abyss. He said that the year he lived with Abyss was his happiest day in 1,000 years. Others couldn't understand what Luffy said, but Abyss, who had the whisper fruit, heard it clearly. Abyss looked at Master Long and murmured, "Master Long. I am also very happy to meet you as my friend." As she talked, Abyss started crying again. After all, it was a friend who had been together for more than a year who died, and it was not something that Luffy could resolve with just a few words. At this moment, a slight breaking sound was heard not far away. Hearing this sound, Abyss turned her head and saw a fossil-like dragon egg shattering, and then a newborn Millennium Dragon broke out of its shell. When Abyss saw this young 1,000-year-old dragon, it was as if she was seeing the reincarnation of Lord Dragon. Seeing the birth of the little 1,000-year-old dragon, Abyss seemed to have grown up several years in an instant. She no longer cried, but was happy for Master Long who could return home and the newly born little 1,000-year-old dragon. He wiped away his tears and came to Luffy, thanking him and saying, "Luffy, thank you very much for your help." "You're welcome." At this moment, Usopp's 1,000-year dragon and Sanji's 1,000-year dragon, who were going to put the Golden Merle back into the sea, also came to Luffy's side. Ike also flew over with Nami. Ike smiled and took out the monkey charm to change them back to their original appearance. How does it feel to become a thousand-year-old dragon? Hearing Ike's words, Luffy said excitedly, "It's so interesting. Can it be different next time?" Zoro, on the other hand, took out the wine gourd and took a sip and said, "It's a very interesting experience, but I still like the feeling of fighting by myself." Usopp's idea is much simpler. "Ike, next time you fight, you must turn me into a powerful monster." Sanji carefully came to Ike and said, "Ike, do me a favor. Next time there is a beautiful woman, please turn me into a cute dog or cat. Please, I want to experience the rough ocean." As soon as he finished speaking, blood started to flow from Sanji's nose. Although Sanji's voice was not loud, it was still heard by Nami. Nami punched Sanji away with a bloody nose. Zoro also commented with three words, "Kappa. Marine headquarters." What? Most of the Marine fleet under a Commodore in the East China Sea suffered casualties. How did he get around in the East China Sea? Sengoku yelled angrily at the phone bug on the table. Logically speaking, in the East China Sea, the Commodore with the Marine fleet group is basically invincible, and no pirates can solve it. Suddenly, Sengoku thought of a person, Garp's grandson Luffy. If there is anyone who can make such a big noise in the East China Sea, that kid is probably the only one. "Hey, could it be Straw Hat Luffy who did this?" Sengoku asked with some anxiety. "Well, Lord Fleet Admiral, this matter has nothing to do with the private marines, and they have also rescued many marine soldiers who fell into the water and were injured." Sengoku was relieved to hear that it was not Luffy. "Then what exactly happened?" "It's because of the Millennium Dragon. Commodore Nelson wanted to capture the Millennium Dragon, which angered the Millennium Dragon group, and then several Millennium Dragons went out and destroyed nearly half of the Marine fleet." "What is that idiot Brigadier General thinking?" Sengoku became even more angry when he heard that he had provoked a group of wild beasts and damaged Marines' combat power. "As for the Millennium Dragon bones being able to produce elixirs of immortality or something, that's pure fart. The people in the world government were looking everywhere for natural treasures such as increasing lifespan and becoming immortal. Naturally, they found many thousand-year dragon bones and even hunted many of them. Facts have proved that these were just rumors. Gather Nelson's men back together for me. As for that idiot Nelson, I will let Garp bring him back to headquarters for trial." After saying that, Seng Guo hung up the phone, and then called Garp to inform him of what happened in the East China Sea. And also praised Luffy. After all, Luffy and the others also saved the lives of many Marine soldiers. Little did they know, it was Luffy and the others who defeated the Marine warship. His eyes returned to Battleship Island. After solving the Thousand-Year Dragon incident, the Straw Hats had a real meal of steamed buns made by Grandpa Abyss before boarding the Golden Melee and continuing their voyage. The next step is to enter the Grand Line. According to Nami's instructions, everyone steered the Golden Melee towards the Red Earth continent. After arriving at the Red Earth continent, everyone was shocked by the 10,000-meter-high Red Earth continent in front of them. "Nami, how do we cross the Red Earth continent? This is too high." Usopp looked up and found that he could not see the top of the Red Continent with his own eyesight. To be precise, because the Red Continent was too high, he could only see the clouds. Although Nami heard that the Red Earth continent was very tall, she was still shocked when she saw it with her own eyes. But as a navigator, she naturally had to lead the crew across the Red Earth continent. As early as when she was in Rog Town, she had already started collecting intelligence about crossing the Red Earth continent. "Don't worry, our ship can cross the Red Earth continent." As he spoke, Nami pointed to an inconspicuous crack in the Red Earth continent. "That's right. For the entire Red Earth continent, the crack is indeed inconspicuous, but it is enough to pass a large sailing ship." Zoro and Sanji were operating the rudder, and the others looked in the direction of Nami's finger, and saw that the seawater in the crack was flowing upstream, which was very magical. With the current going upstream, the boat can really climb mountains. "Everyone, we must control the ship to enter the portal. If it hits the Red Soil continent on both sides, the ship will be destroyed and everyone will be killed." After hearing Nami's words, everyone became extremely serious. It is very difficult to operate the rudder in turbulent water, especially in the face of such strange rising currents. One mistake could result in a shipwreck and loss of life. Right rudder, right rudder. Luffy, who was standing in front, was giving crazy orders. Zoro and Sanji, who were controlling the rudder, broke the rudder hard. The turbulent water seemed to be playing a tug-of-war game with the two of them, not allowing Zoro and Sanji to complete the steering wheel. In a fit of anger, Zoro used force and broke the rudder of the ship. Seeing that the rudder of the ship was broken off, everyone looked horrified. Ike looked forward and saw that the Golden Merle was about to collide with the Red Earth continent. He immediately started flying thousands of miles behind him, flew to the side of the Golden Merle, and began to push hard. Seeing this scene, Luffy was not slow to react. He wrapped one hand around the mast of the Golden Mary and the other hand around the pillar at the entrance to the upside-down mountain. He used the same force to straighten the Mary. Come over. With both captains and captains working together, the Golden Merle entered the upside-down mountain dangerously and dangerously. When the Golden Merle entered the upside-down mountain, its speed suddenly soared, and the entire ship felt like it was on a roller coaster. Regardless of the strong wind caused by his speed, Luffy still chose to sit on the head of the Golden Mary. Nami stood on the second deck and hugged the duck tightly. This made the duck feel a little difficult to breathe, but it did not dare to flutter because it knew that if Nami let go, it might fall out and be buried in the current. The Golden Merle kept flying for several minutes before breaking through the clouds, and everyone finally saw the scenery of the summit of the Red Earth continent. Just when everyone thought that this difficulty was about to end, they saw a pirate ship rushing to the top at full speed in another rising current. There are four such rising currents in total, and the connected sea areas are East China Sea, South Blue, West Blue, North Blue. After the four seas converge at the top, they will all take the only descending current to enter the Great Line. If the two boats continue, it can be said that they will definitely collide with each other. If they collide, the ship will be destroyed and everyone will be killed. What a coincidence, there are ships from other sea areas riding on the upwelling currents. Nami said, covering her head and feeling a little at a loss. In this way, it's like being infected by the Kodak duck. Ike narrowed his eyes, then took out the bamboo dragonfly, handed it to Luffy and said, Luffy, let's deal with that pirate ship together. Similarly, the pirate ship also saw the Golden Mary, and the captain of this pirate ship also chose to kill the other ship. It's just that they don't have the means to control the air, so they can only choose to take out their cannons and attack with cannons. But before they could fire, Ike and Luffy were already over the ship. Luffy stretched one foot toward the sky, and then struck the pirate ship with a rubber tomahawk. This blow directly shattered the pirate ship. This is not over yet. Ike knows that even if the wreckage of these pirate ships continues to ride the rising sea current to the top, it will still bring danger to the Golden Mary. So he took a deep breath, and a roar of the sky dragon blew all the pirate ship wreckage away. Just like that, this sudden crisis was successfully resolved by Ike and Luffy. By the time Ike and Luffy returned to the ship, the Golden Mary had just dashed out of the updraft. Next is the still exciting descending current. When the ship descended into the middle of the Red Earth continent, Ike held the shrinking flashlight in his hand. He knew he would face a whale named Laboon blocking his way next, so he had to prepare in advance. Just when Ike took out the shrinking flashlight, everyone saw a black wall in front of them, which was Laboon with his head erect. It's going to be really difficult for us to enter the Grand Line. Seeing this scene, Zoro couldn't help but sigh. Hey, I don't have time for you to sigh, hurry up and think of a solution. Usopp shouted in horror. Stop shouting. Sanji patted Usopp's shoulder and pointed at Ike and Luffy who were standing at the front. Usopp was also stunned for a moment when he saw the shrinking flashlight in Ike's hand. I see, use the shrinking flashlight to shrink the wall in front of you. Wait, can the Red Earth continent be reduced if it is so big? Usopp asked in disbelief. Although I don't know if the Red Earth continent can shrink, but, this whale blocking the road should be able to. The members of the Straw Hats above had already seen what the object blocking the road was. It was a huge whale. After seeing the full view of Laboon, Ike, who was standing in front, turned on the shrinking flashlight. When the light shines on Laboon, Laboon's figure begins to gradually become smaller, smaller, and smaller again, until it becomes a circle smaller than the Golden Mermaid, and then stops. Laboon was also a little confused at this time. Laboon is a very emotional and very intelligent whale. His head is covered with dense scars, which are caused by his head against the Red Earth continent all the time. The reason for this is that it once had a group of pirate companions who promised it to come back to pick it up after circumnavigating the Grand Line. But decades later, those pirates did not fulfill their promise. He did not want to believe that he had been deceived by his companions, nor did he want to believe that his companions were dead, so he crashed into the Red Earth continent desperately. After the Golden Melee successfully entered the Grand Line, Ike activated the shrinking flashlight again and transformed Laboon back. After going through untold hardships, the Straw Hats finally successfully entered the Grand Line. At this moment, Laboon came back to his senses and turned to look at the Golden Merlee. He opened his big mouth and swallowed the Golden Merlee regardless. Ike didn't expect that he would avoid the scene of colliding with Laboon and Luffy attacking Laboon's eyes, but Laboon still swallowed the Merlee. The swallowed Golden Melee did not suffer a shipwreck, but instead arrived in a new sea area. There are blue skies, turquoise ocean, and a small island here. I thought we were swallowed by a whale. It turns out it was all an illusion. Usopp said as he wiped the non-existent sweat from his forehead. After hearing Usopp's words, Ike pointed to the sky. Usopp, take a closer look at the clouds and seagulls in the sky. Those are just paintings, not real. After hearing what Ike said, everyone else looked up and found that just as Ike said, the clouds and seagulls in the sky were all paintings. Just when everyone was confused, a huge king squid suddenly appeared and wanted to sink the Golden Merlee. Seeing this scene, Luffy, Sanji, Zoro and others were ready to take action. But before the three of them could take action, there were three bangs and bangs from the isolated island, and then three harpoons pierced the giant squid. Everyone looked towards the island and saw an old man with a flower-like headdress tied on his head walking out of the house on the island. The old man looked very serious, with a chilling air. This made several members of the Straw Hats look nervous, fearing that the old man would suddenly get violent and hurt someone. At this extremely serious moment, the old man suddenly sat on the recliner, then picked up the newspaper at hand and read it, paying no attention to the plans of the Straw Hat members. Seeing such a serious atmosphere, the old man just glared at himself and the others without saying a word, and he lay on the recliner and read the newspaper as if nothing had happened. The grumpy Sanji immediately roared, "Hey! I said, why don't you say something?" Hearing this, the old man raised his head and looked at the Golden Merlee, his eyes still showing a bit of ferocity. Seeing this, Zoro subconsciously pushed the knife out of the sheath, with the intention of taking action at any time. Instinct told Zoro that the old man in front of him was dangerous. The timid Usopp couldn't hold himself any longer. He pointed at the old man and shouted, "Come here if you want to fight. We have cannons." When the old man heard Usopp's words, his eyes widened again, which made Ike think that the old man was about to release Conqueror's Haki. But, this old man might actually have Conqueror's. At least, this old man's strength is definitely not weak, it should be said that he is very strong, because he is the ship's Dr. Crocus of One Piece Gall D. Roger. After hearing Usopp's words, Crocus's expression remained unchanged. "Stop it, someone will die." His tone and expression immediately made Usopp weak. Even Sanji had drops of cold sweat on his forehead. Like Zoro, he could also feel the dangerous aura from Crocus. "Who do you think will die?" Crocus replied without hesitation, "Of course it's me. Sanji. Zoro. Ha 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 ha." At this moment, Luffy, who had been silent until now, suddenly burst into laughter. "Uncle, you are so interesting." Crocus looked at Luffy, or to be precise, at Luffy's straw hat. Just when he was about to say, "This straw hat is indeed suitable for a strong man," Laboon suddenly began to hit the red soil crazily. Due to the behavior of Laboon the whale, his body began to turn upside down. Nami wanted to ask what happened, but Crocus had already jumped into the gastric juice and swam towards a gate. "Hey, this should be the whale's belly, right? Why is there an iron gate?" Usopp asked in disbelief. "Not only that, but the paintings in the sky and the old man are also very weird." Having said this, Nami also breathed a sigh of relief and continued, "But, since there is a gate, it means we can get out of the whale's stomach." "Ha ha ha, that's good. I thought we were going to be pulled out by this whale." Luffy smiled heartlessly. While everyone was talking, the old man disappeared and the whale stabilized, but two strangers flew out from the small door above the gate and fell into the gastric juice. Seeing this, the Straw Hat crew did not stand by and directly fished the two people aboard the Golden Merle. After the two of them regained their breath, they also discovered that they had been rescued by pirates. So you are still here. Villains, I told you, as long as I am still breathing, I will not let you hurt Laboon even a hair. Everyone on the Golden Merle looked at Crocus. Hearing Crocus's words, Mr. Wednesday and Mr. Nine, who were known as villains, started laughing. Oh, ho, 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 and then they both picked up rocket launchers. Even if you say so, it's impossible for us to go back. It is our mission to kill this whale, and you cannot interfere with our whaling today. As soon as the two of them finished speaking, they pointed the muzzle of the rocket launcher at the whale's stomach wall. Kada, kada, just when the two were about to fire, the Kodak ran out of the elf ball again and started to steal the show. Naturally, Mr. Wednesday and Mr. Nine didn't care about the sudden appearance of the duck. Their purpose was just for Laboon. Ike on the side was holding a camera and pointed it at Mr. Wednesday, who is Princess Vivi, and murmured, Canduck, add two funny combinations, how can it feel familiar? Oh, by the way, if Ducky was replaced by Meow, wouldn't it be Team Rocket? As for where Ike's camera came from, of course, he drew it temporarily. Ike was quite lucky, he only drew the camera twice in a row. How could we not record this moment of Princess Vivi's dark history without a camera? But Princess Vivi is also very tired. In order to lurk in Baroque Walker, she pretends to be funny and hangs out with Mr. Nine every day. But as long as he leaves Baroque Walker, he will turn back into the princess who is calm, intelligent and loves her people like a son, so this dark history is very precious. At the same time, Mr. Wednesday and Mr. Nine fired at the same time, intending to make a hole in Laboon's stomach. Crocus, who was standing on the high platform, saw this scene and jumped up without hesitation, using his body to block the shells. Boom! With two sounds, Crocus fell into the gastric juice. Oh ho 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 ho! Mr. Wednesday laughed again when he saw this and said, pointless resistance. If you can withstand the first round of bombardment, can you withstand the second round? Ho ha ha ha, ho ha ha ha. This whale will soon be food for our town. Keda, Keda. The duck held its head and looked at the two laughing men and women, a little confused. It always felt that this scene was familiar. Will they be electrocuted by Pikachu next? Seeing that the two of them were stubborn, Crocus also stared at him. He is a doctor. Although he has extraordinary strength, he rarely does anything to people, but if his bottom line is really touched, he will also absolutely no mercy. Just when he was about to take action, Luffy had already taken action in advance. Luffy easily knocked out Mr. Wednesday and Mr. Nine, and then said with a strange expression, I don't know why, I just want to beat them up. Under the leadership of Crocus, the Golden Merle finally left the whale Laboon's body through the giant door on its stomach wall. Arrive at Twin Heads, Crocus thanked Luffy and told the story of Laboon. Laboon is a whale with human emotions. Naturally, its story also moved everyone in the Straw Hats. After listening to Laboon's story, Luffy looked back at Laboon who had calmed down due to the sedative. Then he walked towards the Golden Merle without saying a word. When Ike saw this, he knew that these idiots were trying to help Laboon by breaking off the mast and making a rubber flower arrangement. Wait, Luffy. When Luffy heard this, he immediately stopped. Hey, I know what you are going to do, but you won't hurt the Golden Merle. As soon as he finished speaking, Ike waved his hand, and a miniature version of the Statue of Liberty appeared in front of Luffy. This is also the bronze level reward that Ike drew. Ike also doesn't understand why he drew the Statue of Liberty. And it's not the original version. Originally, he planned to play it with Ying Chen Hai. But now it can be used by Luffy to provoke Laboon. To prevent Laboon from continuing to crash into the Red Continent, Luffy's idea is simple, that is, a promise. Since the previous Lumba Pirates gave Laboon a promise, Luffy of the Straw Hat Pirates can also give Laboon a new one, commitment. And Luffy can guarantee that his promise is not a lie. He will definitely circle the Grand Route and eventually return here. Luffy looked at the Statue of Liberty, then at the mast of the Golden Merle, and finally he picked up the Statue of Liberty and rushed towards Laboon. At this time, Laboon had a wound on his head that was bleeding. Seeing this, Luffy inserted the Statue of Liberty upside down into the wound without hesitation. Rubber, rubber, flower arrangement. When the raised right hand of the Statue of Liberty was inserted into Laboon's wound, Laboon immediately started to cry in pain, and then roared in anger. Finally, Laboon's whole whale jumped out of the sea and hit Luffy with a headlong blow, killing Luffy standing on his head. Everyone in the Straw Hats and Crocas looked confused and shocked when they saw this scene. Boy, especially Crocas, when he saw Luffy being hit by Laboon, his eyes were splitting. "It's okay," Nami comforted Crocas, "Luffy won't die even if he gets crushed." Luffy was indeed not killed by the head hammer, but he still looked a little embarrassed. After all, they are island whales. Luffy's fight with Laboon is almost like fighting with an island. Luffy's rubber fist hit Laboon's body, but it was basically useless, so he could only choose to hit the eyes and the wounds on Laboon's head. It was also because of Luffy's behavior that Laboon became increasingly angry. In this way, this person and the whale fought back and forth for more than 10 rounds. Naturally, Luffy was always at a disadvantage. Usopp saw Luffy's operation and was a little confused and said, "What on earth is Luffy doing?" Hearing Usopp's question, Ike smiled and said, "He wants to help this whale." "Help it," Ike's answer made the Straw Hats even more confused. At this moment, the battle between Laboon and Luffy also ended with Luffy being sent flying against the wall again. Just when Laboon was about to continue rushing towards Luffy, Luffy smiled and shouted to Laboon, "A draw." Laboon naturally understands human language, so he looked at Luffy with some confusion. "Then I heard Luffy continue to say, 'I'm strong.' Right. You want to beat me, right? We haven't decided the winner yet, so we have to continue fighting. Although your companions are dead, I will always be your opponent. We must fight again to determine the winner. We will come back to you after we have circled the Grand Line for a week." Upon hearing this, Laboon's eyes suddenly became moist. These words were so familiar, reminding him of the last words spoken by his friends in the Lumba Pirates. "We will come back to pick you up after we have circumnavigated the Grand Line. Laboon." The companions on the Golden Mary heard what Luffy said and knew what he was thinking. When Crocus saw this scene, he also showed a happy smile. Now he can be sure that Luffy is the person who inherited Roger's will, and the person Roger is waiting for. Just when Luffy wanted to paint Laboon's head with the Straw Hat Pirates logo to prevent Laboon from continuing to crash into the Red Earth continent, he was stopped by Ike. "Idiot, if you just paint it without treating its wounds, aren't you afraid that it will be poisoned?" After saying this, Ike shook his arms, and flying thousands of miles appeared behind him. Then he flew to Laboon's head and began to use sky healing magic to repair the wounds on Laboon's head. While repairing it, Ike said softly, "You don't have to be so cruel to yourself, Brook is still alive." After Laboon heard the name, Brook, his originally calm body suddenly started to tremble. "Don't get excited." As he spoke, Ike used sky magic that could soothe the soul to calm Laboon down. At this time, the wound on Laboon's head was almost repaired. After returning to the ground, Ike shouted to Laboon, "Brook is still alive, but he is now stuck somewhere on the Grand Line and cannot leave, but I can promise you that I will help you bring Brook back." Crocus was also surprised by Ike's words. "Boy, what did you say? You said Brook with the afro is still alive." Crocus felt incredible. After all, he followed Roger's ship around the Grand Line and finally determined that all the Lombard pirates were killed. "I can't say I'm alive, but I'm not dead either." Ike shook his head and explained. "Brook is a user with the ability of the underworld fruit, and the ability of the underworld fruit is that he can be reborn once after death. After everyone in the Lumba Pirates died, Brook was reborn, but he became a human being who can moving talking skull. Now he is still floating in the Devil's Triangle and unable to get out." After listening to Ike's explanation, Nami asked curiously, "Ike, how do you know so clearly? If I'm not mistaken, the Lombard pirates seemed to have happened 50 years ago." Quote. Ike shrugged and said, "I just know." After Crocus heard Ike say that Brook was a user with the underworld fruit ability, he believed that Brook was still alive. The most excited person present was Laboon. Knowing that Brook is still alive and has now made new friends, Laboon, who is very simple-minded, begins to roll over in the sea, just like when he listened to the Lombard pirates sailing and singing together. Final. In order to prevent Laboon from crashing into the Red Continent, Luffy left the Straw Hat Pirates logo on its head. Although the painting was very ugly, Laboon was very excited. The arrival of Luffy and Ike gave Laboon a reason to continue waiting. Kurokaz was also very pleased to see this scene. After solving the problem of Laboon, Nami decided to stay at the Twin Capes for a while. She wanted to consult Mr. Kurokaz about the Grand Line. Although Nami is indeed a sailing genius, the sailing knowledge she has learned is all for ordinary sea areas. The sea environment of the Grand Line is different from ordinary sea areas. Just when Nami was about to speak, she discovered something terrible. That is, the compass doesn't work well, and it's spinning in crazy circles, and I can't tell the difference between north, south, east and west. Seeing Nami's look, Kurokaz knew that these young people in front of him had not done their homework before entering the Grand Line. Immediately, Kurokaz began to explain the navigation rules of the Grand Line to a few people. In the Grand Line, because each island has a lot of mineral resources, the magnetic field is very chaotic. If you want to sail here, then, you need a navigation tool called a record pointer. Every time the recording pointer reaches an island, it can record the magnetic force of the island and then point to the next island. While Kurokaz was explaining, Sanji also served the dishes he carefully cooked, and the ingredients were the elephant tuna he won in Rog Town. At this time, Nami had no interest in food. All her thoughts were on the so-called record pointer. Sigh, if I had known better, I would have gone to Rog Town to find out more information about the Grand Line. At this moment, Ike stepped forward and took out two record pointers and handed them to Nami and said, "These are the record pointers." "Huh, Ike, where did your record pointer come from?" Ike smiled and said, "One fell off the previous Mr. Nine, and the other one I bought in Rog Town." Hearing that Ike had bought the record pointer in Rog Town early, Nami immediately hugged him and said, "You are indeed a reliable vice captain." After saying this, Nami glanced at Luffy. At this time, Luffy had already eaten all the elephant tuna. It's not like the captain, who only eats every day. Luffy thought Nami was praising him, and smiled silly at Nami. After letting go of Ike, Nami held the two record hands and smiled, "This way we can continue sailing." Just when Nami was about to put away the record pointer, a bang sounded from the side, and then Luffy's figure flew towards Nami at an extremely fast speed. Seeing this, Ike quickly stretched out his hand to pull Nami away, and then kept the record pointer in her hand. The reason why Luffy flew over just now was because Sanji saw that all the elephant tuna he cooked was eaten by Luffy. Nami didn't even get a bite, so she kicked Luffy away in anger. Fortunately, the record pointer was not damaged, but Nami still released his Nami-colored haki and knocked Luffy and Sanji away. After obtaining the record pointer, the Straw Hats set off again. Mr. Nine and Mr. Wednesday, who could not go home without the record pointer, naturally chose to follow the boat. Nami, Usopp and others naturally disagreed. After all, these two were bad guys trying to kill Laboon. But Luffy said it didn't matter. As for Ike, he naturally agreed. After all, he knew Mr. Wednesday's true identity. Saving the entire Alabasta, the value of justice is absolutely incredible. On the following voyage, the entire Straw Hats became busy. The climate of the Grand Line is very strange. Nami's navigation knowledge in the East China Sea cannot be said to be useless at all, but it is of limited use. She had seen it in the East China Sea, where it rained, snowed, and lost its direction due to currents for no apparent reason. "Nami, the waves are getting bigger. Nami, it's foggy." After personally feeling the changes in the sky along the Grand Line, Nami once again held his head with both hands and entered reachable duck mode. At this moment, Kodak ran out of the elf ball in the small pocket on her waist again. Although it was a headache for the celestial phenomena of the Grand Line, Nami still tried his best to direct everyone to control the Golden Melee and leave this sea area as soon as possible. "Nami," an iceberg suddenly appeared in front. Usopp suddenly pointed at an iceberg ahead of him that was several times larger than the Golden Merle and shouted. Naturally, Nami also saw the iceberg. She immediately ran to the rudder of the ship and controlled the rudder with Sanji to avoid the iceberg. Just like on Upside Down Mountain, the strange current below made it difficult to control the boat's helm. Seeing this, Ike quickly stepped forward and took out the shrinking flashlight again and shined it on the iceberg in front of him, making it smaller than the Mary and avoiding the impact of the iceberg. After solving the problem of the iceberg, the Golden Melee encountered a strong typhoon again. Facing the strong wind, Ike used wind barriers to wipe out all the wind blowing towards the Golden Melee. With Ike's wind barriers, everyone had some time to breathe. Sanji took advantage of this time to make some energy replenishing rice balls and distribute them to everyone. A few hours later, the originally overcast sky became clear. Nami knew that the Golden Merley had broken through the sea area with weird weather. Although it was not a lot of work, Nami collapsed on the ground tiredly. At this moment, Zoro, who had been sleeping on the deck, finally woke up. After stretching, Zoro looked at the people slumped on the deck and said, "Hey, even if the weather is nice, are you too lazy?" While speaking, Zoro looked at Nami. "I said, the ship is still on its original route, right? Don't get lost, it will cause everyone a headache if it gets lost." The expressions of Nami, Usopp, and Sanji all turned gloomy at the same time. Zoro, who had no idea what had happened before, approached Mr. Wednesday and Mr. Nine and began to interrogate them about their origins. In the end, Nami couldn't bear it any longer and unleashed her domineering force. Nami hit Zoro on the head with her fist. At this time, Nami's body was full of Nami-colored domineering energy, and there was even mental energy all over her body. Seeing this scene, Ike also looked shocked. "What the hell, are you awakening now?" Nami did not notice her own changes, but glared at Zoro and said, "Thank you for sleeping so leisurely until now. No matter how I call you, you are fast asleep, and now you are still making sarcastic remarks." Zoro was still a little unconvinced and planned to resist, but the Straw Hat's combat power would be reduced by 99.999% when faced with Nami's haki. Seeing that Zoro was still resisting, Nami punched him on the head several more times, causing several big bumps on his head. "As expected of Nami, you are so domineering. Awesome." Ike couldn't help but sigh in his heart. The next voyage will be much smoother. The Golden Mary soon arrived at Whiskey Peak according to the direction pointed by the record pointer. This is the town where Mr. Nine and Mr. Wednesday are located, and it is also a bounty hunter's lair owned by Baroque Walker. After the two saw Whiskey Peak, they jumped into the sea and swam towards Whiskey Peak without hesitation. The Straw Hats naturally chose to enter the Whiskey Mountain Peak, for no other reason than that they needed to record the magnetism here before they could go to the next island. As soon as they entered Whiskey Mountain, they saw a group of townspeople welcoming the pirates. "Welcome to the Grand Line. Welcome to our town. Welcome pirate heroes to Whiskey Peak. Welcome to the hospitable town of Whiskey Mountain. Long live the heroes of the sea." Looking at this group of townspeople welcoming the pirates, Nami, Sanji, and Usopp were all surprised. But the surprise was followed by excitement. They didn't expect that the first stop they entered into the Grand Route would be to encounter a town that welcomed pirates. All they could say was, "It was truly a great route." Ike looked at this scene expressionlessly. He knew that all the townspeople here were bounty hunters, including children, old people, and even women holding babies. "It feels like a MLM den here." Seeing this, Zoro fell into deep thought. Luffy laughed loudly. This scene of welcoming the pirates made him feel very happy, because if he was not mistaken, there would be a big meal waiting for him next. Chapter 51. "Hey, don't get too excited. If I guess correctly, this should be the bounty hunter's lair." Just when Sanji was blowing kisses to the beauties and Usopp was doing various poses, Ike's words suddenly stunned them both. "Ike, are you thinking too much? There are so many people in this town, how can they all be bounty hunters?" Usopp said as he looked at the townspeople on both sides of the river who were smiling brightly. Sanji also echoed, "That's right. Where can a beautiful woman become a bounty hunter?" After saying this, Sanji smiled like a nymphomaniac and waved again to the beauties who were ogling him. Ike didn't want to explain anything, but looked at Nami. Nami actually discovered something was wrong. Although there were many pirates in the Grand Line, how could there be a town that welcomed pirates? After all, good pirates like the Straw Hats are rare among the entire pirate community. Seeing Ike looking at her, Nami nodded, and then released Nami's haki again, punching the stunned Sanji and Usopp with two fists. "No matter what, we'd better listen to Ike and be careful." "Haha." Zoro pushed out the third generation ghost on his waist and sneered, "These bounty hunters really know how to play. They actually got into people's mentality at the entrance of the Grand Line, just in time to try out the new third generation ghost, Thorough. At this time, Zoro had already remembered what the organization code-named Mr. was. It was Baroque Walker who had gone to the East China Sea to invite him to join. Finally, the Straw Hats got off the boat and arrived at their town surrounded by many townspeople, bounty hunters. What follows is just like the original work, a banquet, eating and drinking, nothing less. Ike didn't stop him, nor did he think about destroying this group of bounty hunters now. After all, today's voyage is very tiring, so it would be nice to let them relax. Moreover, Ike also used magic to test the food and found that except for some anesthetics in the wine, there was no poison in the food. Sanji held a dozen beautiful girls in his arms alone. Luffy ate like crazy and exhausted several chefs. Usopp kept bragging to the group of townspeople who admired the heroes of the sea. It's like saving a country, meeting a huge goldfish like an island, leading your friends to the marine base camp, and fighting God in the sky. Although these bounty hunters listened with disdain to Usopp's bragging, they still looked at him with admiration, with the purpose of making him drink a few more sips of wine to get him drunk. Although these people looked down upon him, Ike knew that all of Usopp's boasts came true later on. Is Usopp the legendary prophet? After the operations of the bounty hunters at Whiskey Peak, everyone in the Straw Hats was finally drunk. Just as they were discussing how to divide the spoils and divide Luffy's reward of 30 million at the door of the tavern, Zoro's voice rang. Can you let them have a good sleep? Everyone is very tired from today's voyage. Hearing this voice, everyone looked towards the roof and saw Zoro holding a long knife and looking at them with a sneer. Before the bounty hunter below could speak, several more figures came to the roof. They are Sanji, Usopp, Nami, Ike, and Luffy, who actually fell asleep because he ate so much. Zoro turned around and said with a smile, "Cook, I thought you were really asleep. Green algae head, Ike told me to be careful here, how could I fall asleep?" The bounty hunters below heard the conversation between the two and knew that their plan failed this time. Not only did it fail, but it also cost a lot of food and drinks, so it ended up going to my grandma's house. Mr. 8, a curly-haired man who is also the leader of Whiskey Peak, shouted to the surrounding bounty hunters, "There are just a few of them, come together and take them down." Seeing this, Zoro said to his companions behind him, "Leave them to me, just watch them." No one had any objections to Zoro's words. Ike took out Lake Toya, and at the same time also opened the three Magatama Sharingan. He planned to copy Zoro's swordsmanship. After all, with Lake Toya here, it would be unreasonable for him not to master some swordsmanship. Moreover, in the battle at Whiskey Mountain, Zoro did not use his signature three-sword style, so it was a good time to copy it. As for why not just copy the three-knife style? Of course it's because Ike can't learn the ability to bite something and still speak so clearly. Not talking or calling out the names of skills during battle is really a bit of a loss. Just like that, the battle between Zoro 1 vs the entire town begins. Zoro did not pull out Wado Ikimanji and Kuina. He wanted to test the sword this time and try the third generation ghost sword obtained from Rogue Town. Zoro was like this, running away and playing hide and seek while killing people. After a while, the whole town was filled with people. On the roof, Ike took out his camera again. While using Sharingan to copy Zoro's swordsmanship, he was filming the dark history of Princess Vivi. At this time, Princess Weiwei was standing on her duck Mount Karu, twisting her body while releasing perfume that can anesthetize nerves. By the time Zoro discovered there was something wrong with the perfume, it was already too late. Seeing Zoro kneeling on the ground, Princess Vivi mounted Karu and planned to attack. I don't know if Princess Vivi couldn't bear to attack, or if Karu was real, Karu rushed over with Princess Vivi, directly from the roof fell down. This wave of operations also left Zoro speechless for a while. At the same time, in Marine headquarters, Warring States Fleet Admiral looked at a piece of information and fell into deep thought. Alabasta's rebellion, it's really troublesome. At this moment, Garp walked into Sengoku's office carelessly. Warring States, what do you want me to do? Seeing Garp, Sengoku handed him the information in his hand and said, "See for yourself." Garp did not accept the file, but said directly, "Just tell me directly. This thing gives me a headache." Warring States period. Warring States wanted to angrily complain about Garp's irresponsible attitude, but thinking that Garp had such a temper, he could only take a deep breath and tell the purpose of calling Garp here. A few days ago, the Warring States period received a request for help from King Cobra of Alabasta, and the reason for asking for help was that a revolutionary army rebellion had occurred in their country. Originally, Sengoku planned to send troops directly to resolve the rebellion, but Cobra refused. The reason was, the revolutionary army was all civilians in their country, and he did not want bloodshed to occur. Sengoku knew that Cobra was a good king, but he would be a little confused if Cobra didn't let Marine directly enter Alabasta. Because there is a troublesome existence in Alabasta, that is Shichibukai Crocodile. As a Shichibukai appointed by the world government, Marine has no control over Crocodile unless he commits an unforgivable crime. Such as human trafficking, ordinary plundering of merchant ships, and even confrontation with Marine, Shichibukai can do it as long as it does not touch the bottom line of the world government. This is what makes Marine, who has a righteous mind like Sengoku, very unhappy. Shichibukai's system is a complete insult to the entire Marine. Even if they are unwilling to do so, Marine can only be silent and unable to explain the pain. The reason is that Marine is also an organization under the world government, and it relies on the world government for military expenses and other matters. After communicating with Cobra, Warring States also learned the true purpose of Cobra's help. He doesn't want Marine to help suppress the rebellion. To be precise, as long as the people under his rule can live well, even if he, the king, is forced to step down. But he also knew that there should be someone behind this revolution. The purpose of Cobra's search for Sengoku was to ask Marine to help find the mastermind behind the scenes. When he heard about the Revolutionary Army, Warring States naturally thought of Garp's son Delog, who was the biggest leader of the Revolutionary Army. That's why he brought Garp over. After all, Dorag was his son. After listening to Sengoku's explanation, Garp also fell into deep thought. After pondering, Garp frowned and said, "I know Cobra, he is a good king, and Alabasta is prosperous under his governance. Although Delog is making a revolution, the countries he revolutionized are basically countries where the people are in dire straits because of the world government's wealth. I believe that Alabasta's revolution has absolutely nothing to do with Delog. Although he is in Marine, Garp still knows his son very well." It turns out that Bendorag was also a Marine, and was a backup to the Marine general. It was precisely because he saw the dark side of world government world noble that he chose to quit Marine, change the world, and create the Revolutionary Army. So, he would never interfere in a harmonious country like Alabasta. Instead of saying that Dorag is causing trouble, it's better to say that Crocodile is doing it. Warring States nodded. He also watched Delog grow up and knew Dolag's character very well. "I also believe that this matter has nothing to do with Dorag, but, if we want to enter Alabasta to investigate, we must find a valid reason. And my purpose is not to investigate the Revolutionary Army, but Crocodile. I guess the man behind the Alabasta Rebellion is probably Crocodile." Sengoku knew that pirates were pirates, especially pure pirates like Crocodile or Doflamingo. As long as they had the pot, they would definitely be blamed. "I'm talking about Warring States. Since you also said that this matter has nothing to do with Delog, then you should directly send someone to investigate Crocodile. I have no problem with entering Alabasta in the name of investigating Dorag." In this way, Garp directly sold his son's reputation. Warring States smiled and shook his head and said, "I suddenly thought of a better way. Then let the private Marine enter Alabasta to investigate." Immediately, Warring States revealed his next plan. There is coincidence and inevitability in the plan. That is, the Straw Hats entered Alabasta, and then Smoker behind them entered Alabasta in the name of capturing Luffy. In this way, Luffy helps to muddy the water in Alabasta, and then let Smoker, who is reliable in doing things, conduct an investigation. After hearing Sengoku's plan, Garp just thought about it for a moment before agreeing. Then he took out his phone and started to contact Ike. At the same time, in the town of Whiskey Peak, almost all the bounty hunters here were killed by Zoro. Only Mr. Wednesday still has his duck uncut. This is not Zoro's pity for her, but Sanji's taking action. Sanji's chivalry will never let a beautiful woman be chopped off in front of him. Zoro also understands the temperament of Sanji, a nymphomaniac cook, and has no intention of arguing with him. Just when Zoro took out the wine gourd and was about to take a sip, a man and a woman walked towards this side. The visitors are none other than Baroque Walker's senior agents, Mr. Five and Mr. Valentine. When Valentine's Day saw these low-level bounty hunters lying on the ground one by one, not knowing whether they were alive or dead, she didn't show the slightest pity. Instead, she kept mocking them. "Ha ha ha ha, what a waste, you can't even defeat a pirate swordsman." Hearing this harsh sound, Mr. 8, that is, Ikaram, had a look of reluctance on his face. "You, are you here to see our jokes? Ha ha," Mr. 5 with the explosive head said with a disdainful expression, "we are not that boring. The boss assigned us a task. The goal is to kill the people who know his secret." Mr. Valentine looked at Princess Vivi and continued, "After our investigation, it is really incredible that the boss wanted us to kill someone to identify him. Isn't that right?" The whereabouts of Princess Alabasta, Nefertari Vivi, are still unknown. When Ikaram heard this, his expression suddenly changed, and then he stood up despite the stab wounds on his body, and fired at the two people in front of him. "Princess Vivi, go quickly. I'll stop them." After a burst of gunfire, smoke and dust rose everywhere. As we all know, as long as there is smoke, there will be no harm. After Mr. 5 easily withstood the bombardment, he dug out a piece of booger and flicked it out, directly knocking Ikaram to the ground. Mr. 5 is a user with the ability to explode fruits. The ability of this fruit can be said to be very powerful, but I don't know why, this guy can only use boogers. At this time, everyone in the Straw Hats was still watching the show on the roof. I said, "Does this booger man and that woman treat us like nothing?" Just as Usopp finished speaking, a black figure rushed out, that was Sanji. Sanji saw that the beautiful Lady Vivi was in danger, and he rushed out decisively. But after rushing out, he was troubled again, because Mr. Valentine was also a beautiful woman, and he couldn't do it at all. As a last resort, Sanji had no choice but to change his target midway and kicked Mr. 5 in the face. At the same time, Ike also took action. Holding Toya Lake in his hand, he came to Mr. Valentine's side with extremely fast movement, and whipped her away with a wooden sword. "Huh, why does Ike's action just now look familiar to me?" Nami said curiously. Usopp also nodded and said, "It does look familiar." After saying this, both of them looked at Zoro, who was drinking. "What Ike just used was indeed my sword move. When did he learn it?" Zoro said in surprise. As soon as Ike whipped Mr. Valentine away, the mini phone bug in his pocket rang. Because he had to answer the phone, Ike did not put the phone bug into the cozy cabin. Hearing the sound of the phone bug, puff, 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 Ike held Lake Toya in one hand and took the phone bug out of his pocket with the other hand. "Hello, Ike." After the bug answered the phone, Garp's familiar loud voice came. "Lieutenant General Garp, what do you want from me? Have." Before Garp could finish speaking, the phone bug was snatched away by Sengoku. "Boy Ike, First Marine Fleet Admiral Sengoku. I have a mission here that requires your private marines to perform." Ike didn't expect that his irregular army would also receive a mission. "Okay, just tell me. As long as it doesn't go against the just purpose of our Straw Hats, we can help." Warring States. Warring States felt very unhappy about what Ike said. "Are we marine going against the purpose of justice?" But thinking of this, Sengoku also thought of World Noble Tenryujin, World Government, Shichibukai. Thinking of these, Sengoku could only sigh in his heart, why he is not a free private marine. Sengoku feels that the private marine created by Garp is really good. If there is something that is suppressed by the world government, it can be handed over to the private marine, and then the regular marine will wipe the mess. This is good. If there are any more marine officers who are dissatisfied with the world government's judgment of marine, they can be sent directly to the private marine. Just when Ike answered the phone, Mr. Valentine, who had been whipped away by Ike, stood up again, then lowered his weight and floated into the air, intending to crush Ike to death with a wave of heavy pressure. But Ike didn't care at all about Mr. Valentine's behavior. Instead, it was Vivi who looked at Ike and the phone bug in his hand with a shocked expression. What did I hear? This pirate is talking to Marine Hero Garp and Marine Fleet Admiral Sengoku. Is the relationship between pirates and Marine so close now? No wonder, no wonder no one cares about Crocodile's troubles in Alabasta. This is simply a collusion between officials and gangsters. At this time, Weiwei's mind was completely blank, and he didn't even hear the subsequent conversation between Ike and Warring States. As for Mr. Valentine, when she smashed it down, Ike just turned sideways and dodged it. Mr. Valentine's day is basically no threat to Ike now. Boy Ike, what's going on over there? Warring States asked curiously when he heard the noise coming from the other side of the phone. Nothing, tell me, what mission do you want us to do? I want you to go to Alabasta to investigate the cause of Alabasta's rebellion and who is behind it. Remember, the so-called investigation must have sufficient evidence. Finally, Warring States also added a sentence. This sentence can be said to be very important. Without sufficient evidence, it is impossible to capture Crocodile with the title of Shichibukai. At this time, the Warring States period had placed the mastermind on Crocodile's head. After hearing the mission mentioned by Sengoku, Ike inadvertently glanced at the dull Princess Vivi, and then said, "Don't worry. We can complete this mission. Princess Vivi of Alabasta is with us now." Vivi, who was in a daze, suddenly came to her senses when she heard her name. "You mean Nefertari Vivi, the only daughter of King Alabasta. Hurry, give her the phone bug." Warring States was also happy to hear that Vivi was next to Ike. With Vivi here, as long as the person behind the Alabasta Rebellion is successfully investigated, even if something happens to Cobra, Vivi can come to Marine's rescue as the Nefertari royal family. When Vivi answered the phone, she asked cautiously, "Are you really Mr. Sengoku, Marine Fleet Admiral?" "Yes, I am Sengoku." Then why did you cooperate with the pirates?" Vivi's question stunned Sengoku, and then he quickly thought that the pirates she was talking about were the Straw Hats. "Don't get me wrong, although Luffy and Ike fly the pirate flag, they are Marines, private Marines." Vivi felt that there was something wrong with these words coming from the mouth of a serious Marine Fleet Admiral. Sengoku also felt something was wrong, and by the way, he glanced at Garp who was eating his senbei. Isn't it what Garp said before? But now that the matter has come to this, Sengoku has to admit that the Straw Hats are a private Marine with the skull and crossbones flag. "Vivi, leave your safety to the Straw Hats. I have asked them to investigate the person behind the Alabasta Rebellion. Sengoku Fleet Admiral, although I have no evidence, I can confirm that the culprit behind the Alabasta Rebellion is Shichibukai Crocodile. His purpose should be to seize our Alabasta as a hero. Please also ask Warring States Fleet Admiral to send troops immediately to arrest Crocodile." At this time, Vivi's expression was very serious. There is no longer Mr. Wednesday's funny look, nor the panic of being discovered before. Now all she can think about is her own country and her own citizens. "Princess Vivi, we must have enough evidence before we send troops. You also know how cunning pirates are. If we send troops rashly, not only will Crocodile fail to capture it, but it may also be self-defeating. Now Crocodile considers himself a hero in Alabasta." Quote. Hearing what Warring States said, Princess Vivi also knew that she should not rush this matter. In the end, after the negotiation between the two, Vivi followed the Straw Hats to investigate Crocodile's criminal evidence. By the way, Sengoku also informed Ike about Smoker's fake pursuit of the Straw Hats. After hanging up the phone, Vivi and Ike looked at each other. Vivi smiled, stretched out a hand and said, "I'll leave it to you, Vice Captain Ike." "Haha." Ike reached out and shook Vivi gently and said, "It's not me, it's us. Don't worry, our Straw Hats are very reliable." Just as Ike finished speaking, there was a sound of houses collapsing not far away. The two turned around and saw Luffy and Zoro confronting each other. Seeing this scene, Ike smiled awkwardly and said, "It's common sense to exercise when you're full." Vivi wanted to say, "I know you need to eat enough and exercise, but as for drawing the knife, as for the sword being deadly, is the punch lethal?" Ike also didn't expect that Luffy and Zoro would still fight. Just when Ike wanted to step forward to stop him, Nami took the lead in releasing his Nami-colored haki, sending the two of them flying away. "Huh, Zoro, so you didn't kill them because the food they cooked was unpalatable." After listening to his friend's explanations, Luffy also knew that he had misunderstood Zoro. "Hey, Ike said it before. This is the lair of bounty hunters, which means everyone here is the enemy. Didn't you listen?" Sanji took out the flower that Ike gave and lit it. After taking a sip, he asked speechlessly. Oh, did Ike say that? Luffy had a confused look on his face. Seeing this, everyone in the Straw Hats fell silent. I didn't dwell on Luffy's problem anymore. After all, if Luffy could be obedient, it wouldn't be him. Ike told Alabasta, Crocodile, and the missions given by Sengoku. After learning about the upcoming itinerary, everyone in the Straw Hats was a little confused. After all, Shichibukai is really far away from the East China Sea. But when Ike said that Hawkeye was one of the Shichibukai, Zoro suddenly became willing to fight. Sanji and Luffy's expressions also became serious. Usopp was horrified, thinking of Hawkeye's battle with Zoro. In Usopp's view, Zoro is already as strong as a monster, but even if Zoro faces Hawkeye, he still has no power to fight back. Oh, so, Vivi is the princess of Alabasta, so she is very rich. After listening to Ike's story, Nami's eyes suddenly turned into Bailey. Seeing this, Vivi shook her head and said, although our Alabasta land area is large, most of it is desert, so our Alabasta is actually not very rich. To be precise, we should be very poor. Oh, hearing that Alabasta was very poor, Nami gave up the idea of trying to make money. After all, the country is about to get cold, so it would be a bit unethical to still make money. Different from the original Nami, the current Nami recognizes her identity as a private marine. Naturally, if there is an opportunity to make a lot of money, she will also become a pirate. Nami is not too worried about this trip to Alabasta. After all, there is a regular marine fleet admiral behind it. And as long as you sneak into Alabasta quietly, and then find some evidence and hand it over to the Sengoku fleet admiral, then you will have nothing to do with the Straw Hats. Just when Nami had this thought, two strange creatures came out of nowhere and stood on the roof. These are the two mascots of Baroque Walker, one is a sea otter and the other is a vulture. Although they are two animals, they have human intelligence, and they also have code names. They are the direct subordinates of the boss crocodile. Mr. 13 and Mr. Friday. Mr. 13 held a paintbrush and a drawing board, and in just a few seconds, he drew the portraits of everyone present in the Straw Hats. Vivi's expression changed when she saw this. If these portraits fell into Crocodile's hands, the difficulty of the task would instantly increase 100 times. Just when they finished drawing the portrait and were about to escape, Ike made a decisive move and threw the Toya Lake from his hand, knocking Mr. 13 and Mr. Friday out of the sky. Vivi was relieved to see Mr. 13 and Mr. Friday were beaten down. These two guys specialize in snitching. If they go back, the information about the Straw Hats and Vivi will definitely be sent to Crocodile. By then, it will be a little difficult to return to Alabasta safely. Ike did not kill these two creatures. Ike planned to capture them and keep them as pets. After all, such intelligent animals are rare. Moreover, it is an animal that has been trained and has detection and intelligence capabilities. Ike plans to give his camera to Mr. 13. No matter who fights, it will be responsible for recording the entire process. Then Ike can save these precious videos. Taking out two large iron cages, Ike locked them up. Ike, what should we do with these two guys? Zoro pointed at Mr. 5 and Mr. Valentine, who were already tied up, and asked, should we kill them? In fact, Zoro is also trying to scare these two guys and attack those who have no strength to restrain them. This goes against Zoro's principles. Although the Straw Hats know that Zoro is a joke, Mr. 5 and Valentine don't know. Everyone, don't kill us, we are still useful. We can join you. Mr. 5 was already in tears at this time, he really didn't want to die. Who would want a booger like you? Ike said speechlessly. Then he thought for a moment and said, put it on the boat. Just leave it to Smoker and the others to deal with it then. Hearing what Ike said, Mr. 5 and Valentine's Day also breathed a sigh of relief. At this moment, Ike suddenly thought of something, by the way. Zoro, this Valentine's Day has the ability to change her own weight. You can use her as a dumbbell. Ike's words also made Zoro's eyes light up. The dumbbells he uses now are not heavy enough. It would be nice to have dumbbells that can be adjusted freely, but they are a little too soft and may be uncomfortable to lift. Forget it, although this woman's abilities are easy to use, but she's too weak. Ike didn't expect that Tang Tang Suoda would be quite sympathetic to her. After discussing everything, everyone planned to leave here on the Golden Melee. At this moment, Vivi's guard Captain Ikaram came to everyone and said, "Princess Vivi, I won't go with you. I want to go back to Alabasta alone and inform His Majesty the King of everything we investigated." After hearing what Ikaram said, Ike refused Vivi directly without waiting for her to speak. "Forget it, now we are not sure whether Baroque Walker sent a killer. It is too dangerous for you to go to Alabasta alone." Ike knew that if Ikaram set off alone, he would explode on the spot. Although he didn't die and was saved by Robin, there was no need for a good man like Ikaram to suffer that kind of fate. After hearing what Ike said, Ikaram thought about it for a moment and then agreed. Just like that, four more people and two animals were added to the Straw Hats. They are Princess Vivi, Ikaram, Mr. 5, Mr. Valentine's Day, Mr. 13, Mr. Valentine's Day. It has to be said that after suddenly adding four people, the Golden Merlin was somewhat insufficient. So, Ike directly locked Mr. 5, Mr. Valentine, Mr. 13 and Mr. Valentine into his cozy cabin. Every move of the four gangsters after they were locked up in the cozy hut was under Ike's control, and there was no possibility of escaping from there. Just as the ship of the Golden Mary had just left the port of Whiskey Peak Town, an explosion sounded not far away. Everyone looked in the direction of the explosion and saw that the ship that Ikaram had prepared exploded on the spot. Seeing this scene, Ikaram also turned pale. If Ike hadn't stopped him, Ikaram would have turned into a wreckage in the explosion. Thinking of this, Ikaram came to Ike and bowed deeply and said, "Thank you very much, Mr. Ike, for your life-saving grace." Ike smiled and waved his hand to indicate that it was nothing. Just as the Golden Melly was about to leave the tributary of Whiskey Peak and enter the Grand Line, a somewhat voice sounded from the deck of the second floor of the Melly. "It's great to escape from a senior agent. Oh, does this count as an escape?" Ike asked with a smile. At this time, everyone also noticed a woman who suddenly appeared on the second floor deck. The woman was wearing a cowboy outfit and a purple cowboy hat, with her legs crossed and one hand on her cheek, always looking at everyone present with a faint smile on her face. The person who came was none other than Nico Robin. Seeing this woman who suddenly appeared, everyone was ready to fight. Robin glanced at everyone present, then used his devil fruit ability to knock the weapons out of everyone's hands, and finally looked at Ike, who was the first to notice him. "You are the only one on this boat who has no ill intentions towards me. Can I ask why?" Nico Robin, who has been on the run since he was a child, is very sensitive to the malice of people around him. After all, he still has a bounty of 79 million Baileys on him. If he didn't have this ability, he would have been arrested long ago. In exchange for a bounty. It was also because of this that she was a little curious as to why Ike had no ill intentions towards her. Hearing Nico Robin's question, Ike smiled and said, "Of course it's because you don't have any ill intentions, so I don't have any ill intentions either." When Nico Robin heard this, her smile became even brighter, and she immediately took out a permanent pointer and said, "This is a permanent pointer that allows you to bypass the next island garden." After saying that, Robin threw the permanent pointer to Ike, and Ike took it and handed it directly to Luffy, because Luffy was the captain of this ship. Luffy and others already knew through Vivi and Ikaram's explanations that the woman in front of them was Crocodile's partner. Similarly, the reason why Vivi was able to investigate that the person behind Baroque Walker was Crocodile was inextricably related to the woman in front of her. Vivi guessed that every move she made was part of this woman's calculations. It was probably the woman who told Crocodile that his identity was exposed. Vivi didn't understand what Nico Robin wanted to do, so she felt unspeakably uncomfortable facing this woman. After Luffy knew that the woman in front of him was his enemy, he crushed the permanent pointer to pieces without hesitation. And said, "You don't have to decide the course of this ship." Ike was not surprised by Luffy's behavior. There was a theatrical version of the original work, in which Luffy obtained a permanent pointer to Raftru. At that time, Luffy still did not choose this permanent pointer that would directly allow him to become One Piece. Although Luffy is moving towards his goal, this process of running towards his goal is what makes him happiest. Seeing Luffy's behavior, Nico Robin smiled and planned to leave. Originally, Ike planned to stop Robin directly. But after thinking about it carefully, I feel that it is a bit unreliable. If Ike really forces Robin to keep him, can Robin really join the Straw Hats? In the original book, Robin did join the Straw Hats just to have a temporary place to stay at the beginning, and he actually had no sense of belonging to the Straw Hats. After the Sky Island chapter, Robin began to gradually integrate into the Straw Hats, and even in the later Justice Island chapter, they chose to give up their lives and freedom in order to prevent CP from harming Luffy. So, Ike felt that when faced with the problem of companions getting on the ship, it would be better to keep the original plot. Just after Nico Robin left here on the giant turtle, Zoro came to Ike and asked curiously, "Why didn't you take action to keep her?" Ike smiled when he heard this and said, "My chivalry does not allow me to take action against the lady." Zoro looked at Ike speechlessly and thought to himself, "Do you think you are a perverted cook? I see you didn't have any chivalry when you beat up Mr. Valentine." Zoro knew that Ike didn't want to talk, so he didn't ask any more questions. The next step is to decide the route of the Golden Merle. There is a permanent pointer directly to Alabasta in Ikaram's hands. But, Luffy at this time wanted to go to the next island according to the record pointer, which was the small garden mentioned by Robin. As for the reason, of course, it was because the name Little Garden interested Luffy. Originally, Ikaram wanted to refuse, after all, now the entire Alabasta is in dire straits. But before he could speak, Princess Vivi stopped him in advance. Vivi is a very smart girl, especially when it comes to handling interpersonal relationships. On this ship, although Luffy seems unreliable, all the crew members are led by him. Luffy wants to go to the small garden. Even if the crew says they don't want to go because it's dangerous, they won't object strongly. Ikaram, the situation in Alabasta is not as bad as imagined. At least, my father is still there and the ministers are still there. The most important thing for us now is to ensure our own safety. Only when we are safe can we have the opportunity to contact Marine and overthrow Crocodile's conspiracy. As for Vivi, Ikaram just thought about it for a moment and figured it out. At the same time, he also found that his princess had more and more potential as a king, and her overall view was much better than that of his minister. In this way, the Golden Merle set off and headed to the small garden in the direction pointed by the record pointer. After the Golden Merle entered the route and sailed normally, Ike took out the bronze reward compound bow that he had drawn previously. Ike planned to practice his bow and arrow skills. After all, he still had a spiritual bow, a powerful weapon, and it would be a waste if he couldn't shoot accurately. After taking out the compound bow, Ike took out a round drifting kayak, placed a target on it, and finally tied it to the stern of the Merle. Usopp, Luffy, Vivi and Ikaram, who had nothing to do, came over curiously when they saw Ike's actions. Seeing the curious looks of the four people, Ike smiled, shook the compound bow in his hand and said, "Let me show you what it means to pierce the Yang with 100 steps. After saying this, Ike took out an arrow and put it on the string of the compound bow and made a standard bow drawing posture. It was the first time for everyone present to see such a strange-looking bow and arrow, and they all wanted to see how powerful such a bow and arrow was. The target is about 20 meters away from Ike. If it is on flat land, 20 meters is not difficult for a person who can play bow and arrow. But at this time at sea, with the low buff blessing of waves, if you want this, it's not that simple anymore." Ike aimed for a long time, and at the moment when the bullseye was stable, Ike let go of the bowstring with his right hand. Just hearing a swish sound, the arrow passed the target without hesitation. Ike was very embarrassed to see this. It's only 20 meters and it misses the target. If it's 100 meters or 200 meters, wouldn't it be even more completely wrong? Ike knows that in the world of pirates, snipers can shoot enemies at a distance of several thousand meters or even tens of thousands of meters. Just when Ike was embarrassed, Vivi stepped forward and smiled and said, "I have practiced archery in the palace for many years, so let me try it." Hearing this, Ike handed the compound bow to Vivi. After Vivi took the compound bow, she pulled the bowstring a few times before skillfully bending the bow and setting an arrow. She released the bowstring without much aim. Unlike Ike, Vivi hit the target easily. Although it wasn't the bull's eye, it was still pretty impressive. Seeing this, Luffy also had fun. Luffy's situation is the same as Ike's, with the same miss. As a sniper, Usopp naturally gave it a try. Ike also wants to see if Usopp is only good at slingshots. After Usopp took the compound bow, he first pulled it, then tried to aim it, then took out the arrows, strung the bow and started aiming at the target 20 meters away. When Yusopra's bow was strung, his whole temperament changed. Unlike slingshots, bows and arrows have been used as weapons for killing people since ancient times. The temperament of Usopp who uses bows and arrows will naturally change from that of Usopp who uses slingshots. Just when Usopp was aiming, the sea wind suddenly became stronger, and with the change of the sea wind, the waves suddenly surged. Seeing this scene, Ike knew that Usopp must have missed his shot. The current waves would even submerge the target, so how could he possibly hit it? But in this harsh environment, Usopp actually chose to loosen the bowstring and shoot the bow and arrow. Just hearing a swish sound, the arrow penetrated the waves and hit the bullseye. Ike was also amazed when he saw this. Luffy stepped forward and patted Usopp on the shoulder and said, "As expected of our sniper, he is so powerful." Usopp didn't expect that he could actually hit the target. He was stunned for a moment, and then boasted, "Ha ha ha ha. I am the sniper King Usopp. Let alone the 50-meter target, even if it is 500 I also hit the target." Upon hearing this, Ike immediately loosened the rope tied to the target, directly changing it from 20 meters to 100 meters. Ike pointed at the target that had become 100 meters away and said, "Usopp, try again." Seeing this, Usopp wanted to give up. After all, how could he hit the target at 100 meters and with the blessing of the waves? The most important thing is that not only is the target rising and falling in the waves, but the Golden Merle is also constantly shaking. Seeing that Usopp was a little unsure, Ike took out a bamboo dragonfly and said, "Usopp, you don't need to hit the bullseye, but as long as you can hit the target, I will give you this bamboo dragonfly." Usopp's eyes lit up when he saw the bamboo dragonfly. Luffy had used the bamboo dragonfly before, and the way it flew freely made Usopp envious. The most important thing was that after Luffy finished using the bamboo dragonfly, Ike took it back. There is no other reason than that the bamboo dragonfly in Luffy's hands might cause everyone to get lost. Why is it not Luffy who is lost, but the other friends? That's because in Luffy's mind, it's impossible for him to get lost. He can't find his companions. It's only possible that his unreliable companions have gotten lost. After seeing the bamboo dragonfly, Usopp also wanted to try it. Anyway, if you miss, you won't suffer any loss. At most, your lie will be exposed. This time Usopp seriously pulled down the goggles on his head, and then began to draw the bow and take aim seriously. At this moment, Sanji, Zoro, and Nami also came over. Seeing Usopp's serious look, everyone remained silent and even suppressed their breathing. Usopp also entered a state of concentration, and all he could see was the target 100 meters away. He was calculating the ups and downs of the waves. When the waves rose and fell, he loosened his bowstring and the arrow flew out of the air. At this time, everyone set their sights in the direction of the target. Ike took out a telescope. When he saw the arrow stuck in the center of the target, Ike shouted in his heart, "Usopp is god tier." It was also because of this arrow that Ike made a painful but reasonable decision. Others also saw Usopp hitting the target, and immediately began to praise Usopp's sniping ability. At this moment, Ike came to the boat again and lengthened the rope a little longer. This time, it was lengthened from 100 meters to 500 meters. This is something Usopp boasted about before. Seeing this, Usopp asked in disbelief, "Speaking of Ike, do you still want me to shoot a 500-meter target?" Although Usopp has good eyesight, 500 meters is still just a small black spot to him. Besides, the range of a compound bow is not as far as 500 meters. After hearing Usopp's words, Ike took off the cross bracelet from his wrist and handed it to Usopp and said, "You shoot with this." Usopp took the bracelet and was a little curious. This thing is just a bracelet. Could it be turned into a bow and arrow? As if he saw Usopp's thoughts, Ike said to Usopp, "Put it on your hand, and then imagine that you have a bow in your hand." Usopp knew that Ike could take out some magical items, so he followed Ike's instructions and began to imagine a bow and arrow in his hand. Just when Usopp had this thought, a gorgeous long bow emitting blue light appeared in his hand. Seeing this scene, Usopp also had a look of surprise on his face. At this moment, Ike's voice came again. "This long bow is called a spiritual bow. It can condense arrows and increase the power of the original arrows. Its range is very long. As for how far, It depends on how the person who uses it controls it. At this moment, Nami recognized the longbow in Usopp's hand. Huh, isn't this the same bow that Ike used to flatten half of the mountain with one arrow last time? After hearing Nami's words, everyone looked over. When Nami saw this, she reminded Eric of the last time he helped the Thousand-Year Dragon. Eric took out his bow and arrow and accidentally flattened the mountain in the distance because he missed the shot. This can be regarded as Ike's dark history. After all, it can shoot Miz directly at a distance of less than 10 meters. It can only be said that Ike is really not suitable for long-range weapons such as bows and arrows. Usopp's eyes also lit up when he heard that the bow and arrow in his hand had such power. Usopp's personality has been relatively negative since he was a child. Although it can't be seen on the surface, he is full of drama in his heart. It is precisely because of this that Perona's negative spirit is useless to him. With the blessing of such an artifact, Usopp also wanted to try whether he could hit a wave target 500 meters away. Usopp held the spiritual bow in his hand, his eyes fixed on the target that was undulating in the waves 500 meters away. From such a distance, could Usopp hit it? Although Nami knew that Usopp's sniping ability was weak, but it was still too much to stand on a boat and attack a target 500 meters away. Zoro did not speak, but made a shish gesture, indicating to Nami to stop talking and watch quietly. Ike also looked at Usopp quietly, and then he turned on Sharingan and looked at the target 500 meters away. After turning on Sharingan, the target is very clear, but no matter how clear it is useless. Being able to see it and being able to hit it are two different concepts. Ike decided that if Usopp could really hit a target 500 meters away, then, let him use the spiritual bow. Ike has given up on his bow and arrow skills. After all, he can miss the target from 20 meters away. It can only be said that Ike himself has no talent for archery. Not only at 20 meters, but when it was less than 10 meters before, Ike could shoot crookedly with a spiritual bow. It can only be said that bows and arrows are really not suitable for him. At the same time, Usopp once again entered a state of concentration. He put on his goggles and began to adjust the focal length of the goggles so that he could see farther. When he felt that he could see the farthest, he pulled the spiritual bow. Just as Usopp pulled the spiritual bow, he felt that his physical strength was constantly being drained by the spiritual bow in his hand. Because it was the first time to use the spiritual bow, Usopp was not sure how much energy he could gather to shoot an arrow as far as 500 meters, so he poured 90% of his energy into it without hesitation. Go in. Usopp is not a physical monster. His 90% physical strength may not even be as strong as Luffy or Ike's 10% physical strength. But even so, the spiritual bow still emitted unparalleled blue light, and a transparent arrow also appeared on the bowstring. After taking aim, Usopp held his breath for a moment, stared at the target, and finally let go of the hand holding the bowstring. The moment the arrow was shot, everyone present heard a sonic explosion, and several people's hair was blown back. After the sonic boom, what everyone saw was the parted sea. At the same time, the target 500 meters away was directly penetrated by arrows, and then the ropes connecting the target rubber boat to the melee were broken. Seeing this scene, everyone's eyes widened. They didn't expect that Usopp's arrow would be so powerful. Usopp was also shocked by the power of the spiritual bow in his hand. Just when Usopp wanted to blow again, his legs weakened and he fell to the ground. Hungry, I'm so hungry, Usopp said to Sanji while holding his stomach. Seeing this, Sanji said, wait a moment, and rushed into the kitchen to cook. Sanji, I want to eat too. Luffy also shouted at Sanji's back. It'll be ready soon, Sanji responded and started cooking. He could see that Usopp was exhausted just after shooting that arrow, so he wanted to make some food that could quickly replenish his energy. Vivi looked at the slowly calming sea and said, the power of this bow and arrow is more powerful than a cannon. Ikaram also echoed, yes. It's just, the price paid for shooting the arrow seems a bit high. At this moment, Ike helped Usopp up and let him lean against the side of the boat, saying, Usopp's control of the spiritual bow is not very good. As long as he can control the spiritual bow perfectly, it won't be like this. Quote. At this moment, Nami, who was holding the telescope, suddenly exclaimed. The arrow Usopp shot, hit a pirate ship several thousand meters away. Hearing Nami's words, Ike was also stunned, and then he received a system prompt that he had earned hundreds of justice points. After seeing the system prompt, Ike only knew that Usopp's arrow just destroyed a pirate ship. Others were also very surprised. After all, it was a pirate ship thousands of meters away, and it was destroyed by Usopp's arrow. Usopp also opened his mouth wide, and finally looked at the cross bracelet on his wrist, and finally gave it back to Ike with some reluctance. Usopp knew that such an awesome artifact was wasted on him. After all, he just fired one arrow and it was instantly gone. If it were given to physical monsters like Ike or Luffy, it would be no problem to shoot many arrows. Seeing Usopp hand over the spiritual bow, Ike shook his head and said, "You can use this." Usopp was also stunned when he heard this. If you want to use it well, you must exercise well to increase your physical strength. In addition, you must learn to control the power of the spiritual bow. Before you can use your physical strength wantonly, you can choose to use physical arrows. This will consume less physical energy. Hearing what Ike said, Usopp knew that he really wanted to give this artifact to himself. Looking at the spiritual bow in his hand, Usopp nodded solemnly and said, "Don't worry, Ike, I will train hard and live up to it." At this moment, Zoro touched his chin and looked at Usopp and said, "Do you want to exercise with me?" Usopp, "Well, I'd better exercise by myself." Usopp knows that Zoro exercises with several tons of barbells every day. He is simply a barbell monster. Usopp believes that he will never be able to bear it. At this moment, he suddenly took out a solar-powered treadmill and said to Usopp, "Zoro's exercise method is too abnormal. This treadmill is perfect for you." Seeing the treadmill, Usopp looked at Ike gratefully. "And Ike wants to say that after you use this treadmill, you may not be grateful to me." Sanji's food was prepared very quickly, and it happened to be lunchtime. Everyone came to the kitchen and started eating. Usopp also increased his eating speed and even started competing with Luffy for food. While everyone was eating, the Kodak ran out of the pokeball on Nami's waist again. Seeing this, Sanji also prepared a set meal specially for Kodak Duck. After all, the Kodak is a Pokemon and naturally eats different food than humans. Sanji also spent several days researching on the Kodak meal. The appearance of the Kodak immediately made Princess Vivi's Karu Duck excited. After all, they are both ducks, and they felt like they were seeing the same species. After the meal, Ike entered the cozy hut with the food that Sanji had prepared in advance. He has not forgotten that there are still a few unlucky guys imprisoned in the cozy little house. After arriving at the cozy hut, Ike saw the booger men Mr. 5 and Mr. Valentine playing game consoles, while Mr. 13 and Mr. Friday were watching from the side, shouting excitedly from time to time. The games in Warm House were purchased by Ike before. The games are all small games, such as Super Mario, Contra, etc. These games are common to Ike, but people who come into contact with them for the first time can get deeply involved in them. Seeing Ike enter the cozy hut, the two people who were playing the game immediately stopped what they were doing. They both also knew that they were prisoners, and playing games so blatantly was a bit too arrogant and disrespectful to the kidnappers. Seeing this, Ike didn't say anything. After putting down the food, he signaled to the others that they could continue, and he left the cozy hut directly. Although the environment of the cozy cabin is good, Ike still likes the noisy and cheerful atmosphere on the Mary. On the deck of the Mary, Usopp was put on the Leaky Cauldron treadmill. At this time, he was already a little tired and exhausted. He finally understood why this treadmill was called the Burning Cauldron, because it was impossible to stop before the set time was over, and he could not even get out of the cage, so he could only choose to run inside. Usopp, who was sweating profusely, said feebly to Ike sitting beside him, I'm about to die. Ike, let me out. There's still half an hour left, just hold on a little longer. Ike said without raising his head. Usopp felt that his legs were no longer his own. Because he didn't know the function of the Burning Cauldron treadmill, he directly set a 5-hour package for himself. This could be regarded as a trap for himself. Luffy was looking at Usopp with envy from outside the Leaky Cauldron treadmill. Luffy also wanted to play, but Ike refused to let him go. For no other reason than this treadmill was not too strong for Luffy. Luffy is the one who can step on the water dispenser on the Mary. The leaky cauldron treadmill will probably be scrapped before he can use it for long. Ignoring Usopp, Ike began to sort out some of the bronze level items he had drawn before, such as some scraps, and threw them directly into the sea. I didn't take out Ike who was needed for the time being. I planned to take it out again when I needed it. What is now in front of Ike is a set of shurikens. There are 50 shurikens in this set. When I think of shuriken, Ike thinks of Uchiha Itachi's handsome shuriken manipulation technique. Uchiha Itachi has a Sharingan, and he also has a Sharingan, so Ike wants to see if he can practice it and come up with a cool skill like shuriken manipulation. Taking out a shuriken, Ike flicked his hand and shot towards the mast. Ike's position is 4 or 5 meters away from the mast. Ike is very confident that this shuriken can be easily nailed to the mast. But what Ike didn't expect was that at a distance of 5 meters, the shuriken shot strangely missed, and passed over the mast and hit Zoro who was sleeping. Zoro heard the sound of breaking through the air, subconsciously raised his hand and said a word, only to hear a ding sound, and the shuriken fell on the deck. I said, Ike, are you going to murder? Hearing this, Ike smiled sheepishly, then took out a bottle of Motai from the system space and handed it over, sorry. Mistake. Taking the Motai, Zoro opened the lid and smelled it, secretly saying, good wine. Since getting the wine gourd, Zoro rarely drinks ready-made wine. His favorite thing is to pour various liquids into the wine gourd and then taste the wine poured out of the wine gourd. Just like pouring juice into a wine gourd, what comes out is fruit wine. Pour seawater in, and what comes out is bitter wine. Pour the milk in and a milky white milk wine will appear. But the smell of the Motai in my hand is more fragrant than any wine brewed by the wine gourd. Seeing that Zoro was already immersed in the smell of Motai, Ike continued to play with the shuriken. This time, he no longer threw the shuriken so casually, but activated the Sharingan and was fully prepared. When I was shooting arrows before, Ike also turned on Sharingan. If he missed the target on the waves, it could only be regarded as his lack of skills. But now on the boat, and the distance was only 5 meters, Ike really didn't believe that he could still miss the target. Of course, the missed shot just now doesn't count. Ike looked unconfidently to see if there was anyone behind the mast. After finding that there was no one, Ike took out 2 shurikens and started practicing. 1 shot, 2 shots, 3 shots, 4 shots. 10 shurikens were fired in succession, 9 of which missed the target, and the last one was nailed to the edge of the mast, which was also far away from the center point. Something's wrong, definitely something's wrong. If something goes wrong, there must be a monster. Ike doesn't believe that he will miss the mast at this distance. He definitely has some kind of negative buff. Thinking of this, Ike opened the system screen and began to check his abilities and items. Soon, he discovered something was wrong, and that was the Sky Dragon Slaying magic he had mastered. Sky Dragon Slayer Magic Crystal Gold. After use, you can use Sky Dragon Slayer magic. Note: the conditions for using Dragon Slaying magic have been modified according to the system of the One Piece world. Because the entry is not long enough, the note is followed by an ellipsis. Ike pointed at the ellipses and finally saw the whole annotation clearly. Note: the conditions for using Dragon Slaying magic have been modified based on the system of the One Piece world. The negative buff that stuns transportation vehicles has been removed based on the host's own situation. It has been modified so that thrown objects have a 99.9% chance of not shooting. Hitting the target, the thrown objects include firearms, bows and other long-range anti-personnel weapons. After reading this comment, Ike felt bad. He originally thought that the reason why he would not get the negative buff of seasickness after using the Dragon Crystal was because the ability he possessed was Sky Dragon Slaying magic. After all, in the original work of Fairy Tail, Wendy didn't get dizzy when using transportation. Although her hips still stretched in the later stages, at least she was very stable in the early stage. Now it seems that it's not that I don't get dizzy on transportation, but the negative buff was changed to throwing idiots due to my own reasons. Thinking of this, Ike looked at the shuriken that was still placed beside him, and sighed helplessly, so I can't play with guns anymore, right? Ike also got a Desert Eagle pistol before. Firearms are a man's romance. But now Ike no longer has this romance. At this moment, there was a sound of the cage opening. Ike looked back and found that Usopp had finally completed his 5-hour run and walked out of the leaky cauldron treadmill. I finally. Just when Usopp walked out of the cage holding the treadmill, Ike, who was feeling very unhappy, kicked him out and kicked Usopp into the cage again, and then gave him another 2 hours of running time. In Ike's words, Usopp's training is not enough, 2 hours as his reward. Since he has lost a romance, Ike must make up for it with Usopp. Ike, don't do this. If you keep running, I will run to death. Hearing this, Ike took out the candy box from his pocket, and then threw the candy he had prepared at Usopp. This candy can quickly restore your physical strength. You can fight for another 5 hours after eating it. Usopp was relieved when he heard this. He knew how magical the candies in Ike's candy box were. But, just when Usopp was about to receive the candy, the jelly bean jumped over the leaky cauldron treadmill and fell into the sea. Ike, oops, I forgot, I'm still not allowed to throw things. After sailing for several days, Ike, standing on the deck of the Golden Mary, finally saw the next island, Small Garden. It was called a small garden, but, from 1,000 meters away, Ike could already see the towering trees growing everywhere on the island, and beast roars could be heard from time to time on the island. Next to Ike is Usopp, who is obviously stronger than before. Usopp has been trained hard by Ike these days. His activities in the past few days have been to stay in the leaky cauldron treadmill, or to eat meat like crazy. The rest of the time is spent sleeping and practicing archery and mastering the spiritual bow. Daily activities can be said to be very regular. Ike also admires Usopp very much. After just a few days of exercise, Usopp's physique has improved significantly. I don't know if everyone in the One Piece world is like this, or if Usopp is gifted. Seeing Ike deep in thought, Usopp thought that he was trying to fix himself again. Thinking of the painful experiences in the past few days, Usopp immediately stayed away from Ike's sight. Ike is indeed thinking of ways to continue training Usopp, but recently he hasn't found any items that can help Usopp train. But I did get some martial arts secrets such as the 18 palms of subduing the dragon, the 9 swords of Dugu, and the Lingbo Weibu. Ike plans to hand it over to his Straw Hat friends after he has learned it. After all, the friends of the Straw Hats don't understand Chinese culture, so it would be difficult to rely on reading books to learn. The most important thing is, these secret books are all in Chinese. The Golden Merle finally entered a tributary of the Small Garden. After lowering the anchor, everyone in the Straw Hats planned to explore the small garden individually. The originally timid Usopp may have gained a little more courage due to the training he had experienced in the past few days, coupled with the spiritual bow he carried in his hand, and did not say that he had a disease that prevented him from going to the island. Finally, a group of Luffy, Vivi, Usopp, and Karu went on an expedition, while Zoro and Sanji were responsible for hunting. Ike, Nami, Ikarim and Kodak stayed on the Golden Mary to watch the ship. Now the small garden is not dangerous to the Straw Hats, and the two strongest giants are not bad guys. As for Mr. 3 and Mr. Golden Week in the original work, they should not appear. In the original work, they will appear because of Croc, the mission given by Dar. Now Crocodile is probably still a little unclear about where Mr. 5, Mr. Valentine, Mr. 13 and Mr. Friday have gone. For intelligence, he can only rely on Nico Robin, who is out in the field. But how could Nico Robin completely listen to him? So Ike estimated that Mr. 3 did not receive the killing mission. Other side, at the same time that the Straw Hats arrived at the Little Garden, a marine warship also appeared in the waters near the Little Garden. Smoker was holding 2 cigars in his mouth and thinking deeply. Colonel Smoker, the island ahead is the Small Garden. A marine soldier saluted Smoker and said, I know. Smoker took 2 puffs of smoke and said, Straw Hat boy, Ike, we are going to meet again. At this moment, Dasky, who had always been standing behind Smoker, asked curiously, Colonel Smoker, is there really any private marine? HMPH, since Sengoku Fleet Admiral has said it himself, just listen. Smoker said calmly. Hearing Smoker's words, Dasky was speechless. Although they didn't get along for too long, he knew that his boss was a super problem child in marine, and it would be crazy to listen to his boss. Unless, he also admits in his heart the so-called private marine. However, Tashi is quite happy about the fact that the Straw Hats are a private marine, because if they were a private marine, The famous sword in Zoro's hand would not cry because of his identity, and he would not have to think of other ideas. Taking the knife back from Zoro's hand. Before, Sengoku Fleet Admiral had personally called Smoker and informed Smoker about the private marine and the wrong wanted order, as well as the route chosen by the Straw Hats. Smoker did not agree with the so-called private marine. He did not believe that a group of fools with skull and crossbones flags could do anything righteous. But when he received the information from Donghai, he also fell silent. Shieldstown captured Colonel Manka, who was causing trouble. Orangetown solved the Buggy Pirates and brought peace to the entire Orangetown. Unfortunately, Buggy was left to rescue the Buggy Pirates in the end. Silib Village eliminated the Black Cat Pirates and Beiji Crow, saved the residents of the island, and handed over all the captured pirates alive to Marine. Kokoja Village solved the Dragon Pirates, which had been entrenched in the East China Sea for many years and enslaved mankind, and was eliminated by the Straw Hats. It was also because of this incident that the Straw Hats were stabbed in the back by a Marine scum mouse colonel and became a bounty prisoner. In addition, outside of Rog Town, Ike also defeated no less than 5 small and medium-sized pirate groups. Even if this record is obtained by the Marine headquarters, it can be regarded as a model worker-level Marine. Smoker was shocked when he learned about all these things. There are only a few famous pirate groups in the East China Sea, and now they are all destroyed by the Straw Hats. In fact, Smoker plans to personally take action against these famous pirate groups, especially the Dragon Pirates. But because the Dragon Pirates are subordinates of Shichibukai Jinbei, the world government completely turns a blind eye to their evil deeds, but Smoker doesn't care whether Shichibukai is Shichibukai or not. He himself is Marine's problem, child. It was also because of disobeying military orders that he was brought to the East China Sea, a place where no one can shit. But before Smoker could take action, the Straw Hats had already dealt with them. After reading all the information about the Straw Hats, Smoker can confirm that the Straw Hats are indeed private Marines flying the skull and crossbones flag. And everything he did was in line with his wishes, whether it was defeating the scum Marine or cleaning up the scum pirates. In short, our goal this time is to investigate Crocodile in the name of hunting down the Straw Hats, and to protect Princess Alabasta of the Straw Hats. After saying this, Smoker smiled. Doing Shichibukai or something like that is something he has wanted to do for a long time. Smoker is a Marine, and he is the kind of Marine who is merciless when facing pirates. Naturally, he does not agree with the so-called Shichibukai system. This system is simply nonsense. The world government actually allows a group of pirates to carry out plunder reasonably and legally. No matter what they think, they are stepping on Marine's face. If Crocodile is really caught this time, Smoker can arrest him personally. The crime of trying to control the member countries of the world government can definitely disqualify Crocodile from Shichibukai. Because, if this matter spreads, the world government will not be able to stop it. After all, the so much heavenly gold paid by the franchise countries every year is not in vain. If this matter is known to other franchise countries, the sky gold will probably shrink in the second year. Just as Smoker was deep in thought, he finally saw the Golden Merle docked in Little Garden. At the same time, Nami, Ike, and Ikeram also saw the Marine warship, as well as the tall Smoker who had just stood up in front of the warship. Ike waved to Smoker, and Smoker stared at Ike expressionlessly. The Golden Merle and the Marine warship soon got close to each other, and Smoker also jumped onto the Golden Merle with Dusky. "Hey, Smoker, thank you for chasing us for so long." Ike smiled and said hello. "Smoker, Dusky." Ike's words hit a sore spot for Smoker and Dusky. This journey has indeed been very hard. Smoker's first thought was to lead people to chase the Straw Hat Kid, but he forgot who he was letting. Those are all local Marines from the East China Sea Marine Branch, who have never experienced the wind and waves of the Grand Line. After breaking through the windless zone and entering the Grand Line, many Marine soldiers were already weak. If it weren't for the Marines' excessive hips, Smoker would have joined the Straw Hats long ago. Naturally, Smoker didn't come to see the Straw Hats to reminisce about old times. He came to inquire about information about Baroque Walker and Crocodile. After learning Smoker's intention, Ike asked him to find Ikeram. After all, Ikeram has been lurking in Baroque Walker for a long time and knows the staffing there very well. In addition, Ikaram also told Smoker about the information about Crocodile and his guess about Crocodile's intentions. Although I got some information from Sengoku, but Ikaram, the person who experienced it personally, told it in more detail. After listening to Ikaram's story, Smoker looked at Ike and said, "What are your plans next? How do you want us to cooperate?" Hearing Smoker's question, Ike rubbed his chin and thought for a moment before saying, "Let's enter Alabasta first, and then try to see if we can stop the rebels. If we can't stop them, we'll go directly to the Rain Land, which is Crocodile Base Camp, then you can follow our footsteps and make a big fuss." When he heard that there was going to be a big fuss at Shichibukai's base camp, Smoker, who was expressionless and fierce, smiled. This was just what he wanted. Suddenly, there was a sound of heavy footsteps, and everyone turned around and saw a huge dinosaur staring at the people on the two boats. Seeing the dinosaur, Nami's expression also changed, and then he exclaimed, this is actually the ancient island. Smoker, who is well informed, has heard about the ancient island, but this is the first time he has seen it. There are many ancient islands in the Grand Line, especially in the second half of the journey, but there are basically none on the route. This small garden is a special case. If the island is not on the shipping route, it is easy to create an ancient island, because without humans, the island will not develop unless the animals on the island have a unique civilization. Seeing the dinosaur looking at him and the others and drooling, Smoker frowned and planned to kill it and use it as military rations. But before Smoker could take action, a huge axe with a cold look cut off the dinosaur's head. At the same time, a huge figure walked out of the dense woods. It was a giant who was more than 20 meters tall. He held a cold axe in one hand and a huge buckler in the other. Ooh-ha-ha-ha-ha. A burst of huge laughter rang out, and the giant looked at the warship and the people on the Melian and said, "I am Braji, the strongest soldier in Elbaf. Woo-ha-ha-ha-ha-ha." Seeing this giant, the marine soldiers on the marine warship were scared to death. These marine soldiers were basically locals from the East China Sea. They had never seen such a creature before. Not only these marine soldiers, but also Nami, Ikaram, and Dasky looked at Braji, who stretched his head and looked over with frightened expressions. And I don't know if it was infected by the Kodak duck. Now Nami is so nervous and frightened that she will cover her head with her hands. Especially when there is a duck standing next to him, it is a bit funny. When Dasky saw Nami covering the sides of her head with her hands, she also imitated it and looked a little cute. The most calm people present were Ike and Smoker. Ike is really calm because he knows the original character Braji. Maybe it's because there are no people in the small garden all year round, but both Braji and Dongli are very hospitable. And Ike saw that this giant looked like the pictogram of Zhongfei in the Three Kingdoms. It would have been more like it if he was holding a spear instead of an axe. If you think about it carefully, the image of another giant Dongli also looks a bit like the rumored Guan Eri. As for Smoker, although he was calm on the surface, he was very surprised on the inside. Because Elbaf is a name unique to the New World, and giants are a race unique to the New World. It's already weird to appear in the first half of the Grand Line. What's more important is that the giant in front of him is the Red Ghost Braji, whose head is worth 100 million belly. And that reward was nearly 100 years ago. The 100 million baileys 100 years ago was different from now. If you get it now, it would be hundreds of millions or even billions. If Smoker hadn't accidentally seen this giant's information, he really wouldn't have known how awesome the giant in front of him was. 100 years ago, the giant pirate group Braji the Red Ghost dominated the entire Grand Line. Because the entire pirate group was a giant, no one dared to provoke them. Even the world government only issued a wanted order for them and then allowed them to love them. Do whatever you want. At this time, Smoker was a little confused. How could Braji, the Red Ghost and one of the two captains of the giant pirates who once dominated the Grand Line, be here? Just when Smoker was confused, Ike was already chatting with Braji. "Uncle Braji, I think a spear would be more suitable for you." "Yuhahahaha." Hearing Ike's words, Braji laughed again and said, "I used to use a spear, but I had some grudges with a guy, and I felt that using a spear was too much to bully him, so I used a spear. Use an axe instead." Ike, hearing what Braji said, Ike was sure that the prototype of the Braji in front of him was Zhongfei in the Three Kingdoms. At this moment, Raji licked his lips and said, do you have any wine here? I haven't had a drink in a long time. Hearing this, Ike smiled, and then took out several large wine barrels and wine jars from the system space. These wine barrels are all the wine that was drawn before, fruit wine, white wine, red wine, and even the sacred wine brewed by Asan Kingdom. Asan wine is made from cow urine, Ganges water and wine-making materials. Brigitte was very excited to see Ike bring out so many drinks. Ahahaha, thank you so much, little guy. Come on, I'll treat you to my special roasted dinosaur meat. After saying that, Brigitte inserted the axe back into his waist, then took off his cloak behind him and pocketed the wine that Ike had taken out. He carried the dinosaur that he had beheaded before with his other hand and walked towards the depths of the forest. Boy, follow me. There are many dinosaurs in the forest which are quite dangerous. After hearing what Brocky said, Ike followed without hesitation, and Smoker followed after a little consideration. Seeing that Ike and Smoker were following, Nami, Dasky, and Ikeram naturally followed suit. Compared with staying on the boat, they felt safer following Ike and Smoker. Of course, before leaving, Dusky ordered the marine soldiers to take good care of the ship. As for letting the marine soldiers follow, don't be kidding, these are ordinary marine soldiers, and they are marine soldiers from the East China Sea branch who have not experienced much wind and waves. Just entering the Grand Line has already taken a lot of courage from them. If it is too risky, they should wait until the soldiers from the marine headquarters are replenished. At present, these sailors can only do the chores of sailing. I hope everyone will support it and subscribe more.